keep a secret for somebody. You know, let's say, you know, some bad student in the class, they do something outrageous. But you just want to go along with them. So you keep the secret for them. You hold it for them. You don't say nothing. You don't talk about it. You know it's wrong. You know it's not right. You know it's outrageous. You know what happened. But you want to be with this crew, or you don't want nobody to say you a snitch or whatever it is. And basically, this is the same kind of thing that's going on in the church now. It's the same sort of thing that is going on in the church. Amen? That people are keeping secret. But God sees all. God knows all. Amen? So it's amazing what is the kind of thing that you hear and you see that's going on in Christendom now, and people are just going along with it. Amen. So we want to put a light on some of the things today and just open up the conversation, because one thing that came to my spirit strongly is that as we look at it, life, everybody's different in life. Sometimes what you might see and it will go right to the core of your being, and you'll be able to react to it. Another person might have to see it 10, 20 times before they really know what's going on and acknowledge that, wow, you know, this is true, sister. You know, this is true, brother. Wow, I can't believe that this is really what it is. You know what I mean? So we are here for each other, and we should be here for each other. Amen? And that's basically what it is. So I want to, you know, open up with this conversation today, that we are able to share some things and be able to impact each other in some way or the other, that we can make our calling and our election show, and we can continue this journey for Jesus Christ. Amen. We can continue to walk in the counsel of the godly, walk in the right counsel, that we are going to make it right. Psalms 1, right in the beginning of the Psalms, right in the beginning, from the beginning, from the ongo, from the onset. And the thing about God, God put things in strategic location that we should pay attention. Psalms 1, he said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Period. Blessed is that man. It means if you do it, you are not blessed. You won't be blessed. Everything coming from that cannot be blessed. So he said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners. Hallelujah. Nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law doeth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. This is Psalms number 1. Hallelujah. In between this, we read all kind of psalm about healing and all kind of psalm. Oh, deliver me. All kind of psalm. Oh, prosper me. Oh, God. Oh, help me against my enemy. But hear what he's saying up here in number 1. Because you must would have read number 1 before you reach to number 23 and number 4, 24. You must would have read number 1. Amen. So what I want to say this morning, we want to open a light. We want to put on a light this morning for the believers who want to walk. We all want to walk in the counsel of the godly. We all want to do it right. I don't think there is no believer that is out there listening right now that is confident in their mind by living any way they will see God based on what the word of God is saying. It is impossible. If we are in our right mind, we all want to see God. The devil wants us to be dancing, jumping around, forgetting what is important, and paying attention to what will not get us in the presence of God. And we need to be vigilant. We need to shed the light. We need to shine the light. We need to speak to our brothers and sisters. We need to talk. We need to engage in conversation, that we might be able to shake one person, even if it's one person, into the reality of what God is calling for, who God is calling for, and what God wants of us, and what is our divine purpose in the eyes of the Lord. Amen. So I hope that we're going to embark on this conversation this morning, and we're just going to open this up and share this conversation. You know what I mean? Because it's almost like there's a code of silence against unrighteousness in the church. A code of silence. We have taken up with ungodliness. Amen. We have taken up with it. Amen. Are we keeping a secret for the ungodly? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. And like I said, for those of us, the Bible says, to whom much is given, much is required. We understand. There are many people who totally understand what's going on. They know it that everything, whatever is going on, contrary to the word of God, and they deliberately stay right there with the ungodly and continue with them. And there are people who are stuck in some mode. Like I know one guy who used to be a singer back in the days, and he probably took a nice picture with a nice afro back in the days, and he looked cute and young. And even as he's old, he's singing still, and all the picture he wanted to put on the posters is the same one when he was looking so young. Like, so you see him now at the poster and you say, wow, you know. And you get, then you realize this old man come on the mic and start singing, totally different person. You know what I mean? So for those who are stuck in a mode, it's our duty as believers to bring it. Because the Bible says, faith cometh by hearing, and by hearing by the word of God. And once it's conducive to holiness and righteousness, we are called to let our brethren know. Let them know. Tell them what we see. Tell them what we observe. And they themselves also tell us what they observe. Because we all want to make it in God. We all want to see God. We all want to make it in the presence of God. Am I right, brethren? Am I right? We all want to make it in the kingdom of heaven. Amen. I've heard some things that I really and truly cannot believe. Those things are really going on in churches. Amen. It's not a first-hand story, so I cannot say it's my story. But a lady was telling me that some woman was telling her that, you know, some deacon, old man, he's not, he probably married and still want to sleep with her and stuff like that every day, whispering in her ears in the church and all kind of stuff like. I'm thinking, well, how this could be in the church of God? And how could people condone and be in that kind of environment? Amen. We heard of people just sleeping around with more than one woman, just trying out one, engaged to this one, and going along. And people sit right there going along with this thing day by day. Women partake in those things day by day and go along with these kinds of things. Come on. If we want to make it in the kingdom of God, we have to honor the word of God. We have to strive to honor the word of God. We cannot stay in the counsel of the ungodly. We cannot. Amen. Somebody might say, well, oh, he think he holy. Well, you could say what you want. You could talk what you want. But we talking, thus said the Lord, according to the word of God. Amen. We all have to strive to do what God is saying. Amen. Even if I don't make it, but I tell you about it and you do it, well, hey. Praise to you. Good luck to you. But the point is, we cannot look at each other and feel, well, okay, well, if you talk about righteousness, you talk about holiness, well, somebody going to think whatever, so don't talk about it. Just act like nothing happening. No. We got to talk about some stuff, because we want to raise some people up to understand that the most important person that we need to honor is Jesus Christ, the Word of God. It doesn't make no difference. It's not about what country you're from, who know you, what relative, what family they are. That is not what it's about. It's about doing what the word of God say. That is what we need to embark on. Honoring God and honoring the word of God. All right, so I'm going to come back and open the phone line if anybody want to share anything. But we just want to deal with this today. Psalms 1. See. Amen. Thank you for listening. Thank you, Jesus.
You are not alone if you are lonely. When you feel afraid, you're not the only. We are all the same, in need of mercy, to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to lean on, but thank God.
And all the people say amen. 16 minutes after 11 o'clock indeed. Hallelujah. My name is Lamont. Hallelujah. We give him praise this morning. Amen. 347-663-8638. If you want to open the conversation with us, you have something you want to share and what we're talking about this morning or what we're trying to talk about this morning. Amen. I've heard so many stories that is really and truly deplorable as it comes to the church of God, the house of God, children of God, and it should not be named among people of God. Amen. And I think it's our duty as believers to truly come forward and be able to shed some light or to give strength to some people who are weak and feel that they are subject to somebody else. They feel somebody else have the authority on them. And we need to shed the light. Because if you are part of any church or any body of people that is going on and condoning that kinds of behavior, that we're talking about pastors having more than one woman in the church, and I mean, come on, and you know that, and you a woman, and somebody, you the pastor is preaching to you, and then he's trying to touch you, and trying to talk to whisper in your ears, and making eyes for you and stuff, and you sit right there, come on, you're just as guilty. You're just as guilty. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So it's so much stuff that is going on within the body of Christ that should not be. Should not be. And we, this conversation this morning, we really just want to let some people know that, look, you got to defend the word of God. You got to stand for the word of God, period. It has nothing to do with nobody. These have nothing to do with nobody. If it's not right according to the word of God, you need to get out, get away, move away, step away. Let God direct you, but make sure that you want to be in the will of God. You want to be where God wants you to be. You want to be right according to God, according to the word of God. And many people can relate to what I'm talking about. If you're out there, you have something you want to share about this situation you have been in, something you have encountered, definitely indeed feel free to share it with me. We don't have to keep no secret for the devil. We don't have to keep no secret. Amen. We have to expose what the devil, because the devil is trying to make sure he's going to take who he can take. He's going to take who he can take. Amen. Hallelujah. So we got to make sure that we stand up for what is right, what is holiness, what is righteousness, because those who are led by the Spirit are the sons of God. Hallelujah. Galatians 5:16 says to walk in the Spirit, that we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Amen. So we need to stay in the Spirit of God, that we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And many times people feel obligated. They feel they're obligated. It's like, you know, it's like, let's say somebody brought you to America and then, okay, you start living by their house. Well, you feel you're obligated to do whatever they tell you. They want any money, you give it to them. Even if you pay them back for the ticket already, you pay them back for what they have done, but you still feel obligated to do that. And this happens now. It continues now. Somebody did something for you and you feel you obligated. Somebody help you get something, whatever, do something, and don't care how ungodly they're living, you feel that you must go along with them, because how could I embarrass these people? Or how could I leave them? I mean, look at what's going on. You got to make your calling and your election sure. We got to stand on the word of God. Stand on the truth. If they're mad with you, they're mad with you. You got to stand up for Jesus. Amen. 347-663-8638. We just want to spark this conversation this morning. If you're out there and you want to share something, feel free to share it. Amen. We thank God for Jesus this morning. He has set us free from bondage, and we need to stand fast in the liberty by which Christ has set us free, and do not be entangled again in the yoke of bondage. Whatever bondage that makes us go contrary to the Spirit of God, we need to keep moving forward, because we are indeed in the last time. We are in the last days. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. 347-663-8638. If you want to share something, we're talking about Psalms 1. The Bible speaking of Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Amen. And we understand that so much is going on, and there are many people who don't feel they have the power. They don't feel they have what it takes to get up and move away from those that are living contrary to the word of God. We don't owe nobody nothing but Jesus Christ. Amen. Glory to the name of the Lord. 347-663-8638. 347-663-8638. Don't be shy. Don't be intimidated. If you want to share in this forum this morning, just be encouraged that we can call and encourage somebody that you have encountered something totally ungodly, unscriptural, and you stepped away, you got up, you move away. Or if you want some advice in some way, some form, we pray by the Spirit of God we are able to provide some righteous counsel, some godly counsel through the wisdom of God, by scriptures reference or whatever it is you might be able to do today indeed. But we must bring this before the congregation. We must bring this before the listeners, because times draw it nigh and no man knows the hour. No man knows the hour. Even if you're not here for the rapture, you're not here at the end of the world, you're not here, the world didn't end, but nobody knows when he will be taken away. And if we die in that predicament, if we die in an ungodly state, in an unrighteous state before Christ, we cannot see the kingdom of God based on the word of God. So we want to make our calling and our election sure. Hallelujah. And we see the enemies moving in and creeping in the church with all kinds of stuff. Totally unscriptural, totally ungodly. Totally unscriptural, totally ungodly. We was talking about the names and all these things. Where these things come from? It has to be the devil. It is the devil. People tell you they're a doctor. How you could be a doctor? How you could be a doctor in the church? What role is a doctor in the church? What kind of equipment do you use to do your doctoring in the church? What do you doctor? What do you cure? What do you do? Amen. It's so much going on that is unscriptural, ungodly, that people are just running like blind mice and picking up all this thing, running after all this contrary stuff. And the Bible said, be wary of vain glory. This will not prosper you in heaven. This will not give you the kingdom of God. All this is vain glory. For people to see, for people to hear, for people to know you, vain glory in the name of Jesus. And if we don't pay attention and we don't stay sober and we don't stay vigilant according to the word of God, we are going to perish. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So we must be vigilant. Amen. We must be vigilant. We must be sober-minded. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. If you're out there this morning, you have something to share, don't be shy, don't be intimidated. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. 347-663-8638. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We give him praise this morning. We just want to bring this forward. Amen. Because we realize we have engaged many people, and it seems they're speaking from an angle where they feel they don't have what it takes. They don't have the power. They don't feel they have the strength to rise up against what is not holy, what is not righteous, what is not godly. They feel that they're cornered. They feel cornered. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. But liberty is yours in the name of Jesus today. 347-663-8638. All the people say amen. Thank you, Jesus. If you have a word to share, 347-663-8638.
You are not alone if you are lonely when you feel.
God has not lowered his standard. He has not lowered the bar. Everything is just the same.
In need of mercy to be forgiven. Amen. And be free.
347-663-8638.
To lean on bus and God is all you need. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love never ends.
347-663-8638.
If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter.
Walking in the counsel of the ungodly, let's go to the phone line for this first caller. Caller, good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning, grace and peace to you.
Grace and peace, Mr. Straker. How you doing?
I'm doing great in the name of Jesus. How you doing?
I'm highly blessed and favored.
Amen.
I just want to tell the radio land how awesome God is. Oh, we serve a wonderful and awesome God, the Son Jesus Christ, our Lord and soon coming King. Oh, wonderful He is. You know, because the Lord has really been... Hello?
Yes, I'm listening to you. I'm hearing you. All right, sister. I think you need to re-establish your call, relocate yourself. Relocate yourself. Make sure you have an optimal signal on your phone and then call us back. Amen.
You are not alone.
27 minutes on the other side of 11 o'clock.
It's all you got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen.
Hallelujah.
If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know, love is what we're after.
What? I wonder if anybody feel that they're not good enough to call about this conversation. Yeah. You don't feel you're righteous enough.
God knows this stuff.
You don't love God enough. You don't love Jesus enough. You're not sure if you're on the side of Christ or not. Hallelujah. You're not sure if you're righteous enough. You're not sure if you're holy enough. You're not just sure if you're worthy. Or speaking thus said the Lord. 347-663-8638. We're dealing with Psalms 1. Sometimes we're feeling that we're not blessed. But what is our counsel? Who is our counsel? What counsel are we in?
For this is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen.
347-663-8638.
And all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for His love never ends.
We're talking about walking in the council of the ungodly this morning. Staying with them as they continue to live, walk, operate contrary to the word of God. It's all over, widespread.
You are not alone.
God is a serious God.
You are alone.
God is not mocked.
When you feel afraid,
he said, without holiness,
you're not,
no man will see the Lord. Let's go to the phone line. Caller, good morning. Thank you for the call. Go ahead,
well,
caller.
Good morning, Pastor. Good morning.
Grace and peace to you. Good morning.
I'm just calling to support what you're saying. Because there are so many pastors that are covering up, and they know that people look up to them as, you know, examples.
Turn off your radio, mommy. Turn off your radio. That's why you're waiting to hear your voice first before you go forward.
Oh, you're hearing me. I don't want to record. Good. So what I'm trying to say, that they know very what they're doing. God is not mocked. He means what He says. And we should set example leaders. I am not encouraging or supporting. I'm totally against this same-sex marriage business, and if we will call it by its name, people will understand. They can do whatever they want to do because they don't like what we are saying, but it is as the Bible says. They want to blame the president because they know he can't say anything, but it is way back. And they read in the Bible where from Lot's time, where the men, they were destroyed. He offered his virgin daughters, and they said no, they want the men. and they were destroyed. They must take God at his word. Thank you so much for coming out and calling sin by its name, because God is no respecter person, and we all want to be saved. Okay?
Amen. Thank you for the call. Jesus is Lord. Amen. God bless you.
Yes.
Amen.
Very good. And enjoy your music too.
Amen.
Have a wonderful day.
You too, my sister. God bless you. Thank you.
Okay, Pastor. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Yes. 31 minutes on the other side of 11. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Reaching out to all the believers this morning. Amen. Some people's minds are made up. They couldn't care less what the word of God say. But you gotta save your soul from those men. You gotta step away. You gotta save your soul. God is not mocked. Amen. Back in the days, they say you're not popular.
Thanks to the Lord for his,
you go along with the ungodly,
hands,
the rootless.
All the people said amen.
Now you're done with the crew.
If you're rich or poor, well,
same culture continues all the way in the things of God.
You know, love is what
you gotta know. It never worked then. It cannot work now.
We're all broken, but we're all in this.
Make up your mind to be separated unto God.
God knows we stumble.
347-663-8638. If you have a comment this morning,
oh,
you are seeking righteousness, holiness.
Amen. Oh, and all the people said amen.
All the people say amen.
Give thanks to the Lord for his love never ends.
You got the strength, you got the power.
And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart.
You will be persecuted if you stand up for righteousness. You will be. Let it be for Jesus. Let them hate you. Be unpopular for Jesus. For truths and rights. Or else you're all gonna perish. We all gonna perish if we don't stand up for Jesus. Amen. 347-663-8638. If you want to make a comment this morning, is definitely strong on my spirit that we just look into this Psalms number 1. He said that blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. It means if you walk in that counsel, blessings cannot flow the way they're supposed to flow. And many times we look all kinds of ways and we think that we're unlucky with this, with that, with that. Well, we need to just simply take a step back and see what it is that we're doing according to the word of God. Amen. Psalms number 1. He said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. The opposite of blessing is cursing. Amen. It means cursed is the man that walks in the counsel of the ungodly. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. We give him praise because he's always looking at our best interests. We thank God for his truth. Amen. We thank him for his word. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. And like I said, we're reaching out to those who feel that they don't have a voice. They feel that they don't know what to do. They cannot make a move. You will be blamed if you don't make a move after you heard the truth, after you heard the right, after you heard it, after you know you can read, after you understand what the word of God is asking you to do. You must be willing to stand up and say, thus saith the Lord. Hallelujah. I don't care who's mad. I don't care who's upset. I believe in Jesus. I'm not going to walk in ungodliness. I'm not going to support unrighteousness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. The Bible says to try the spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. Sometimes things going on and it cringe your spirit. Well, it's wrong. Your spirit don't receive it. If you believe in Jesus and you're walking in the spirit, when things are contrary to the spirit of God, you need to rise. Let them know that, hey, this is not of God. This is not right. Amen. Hallelujah.
1, 2, 3, 4.
God will not hold you blameless. He said, to whom much is given, much is required. Amen. Just know you're not alone.
And you feel afraid,
we are here with you.
You're not.
If you want to stand up for righteousness and truth,
same,
holiness, godliness, according to the word of God, every man is striving to do it.
Free.
Don't feel you can't do it.
It's all you got to lean on,
but the laws of God are not grievous.
And all the people said amen.
If man wants to have their way, are you going
to
go along with them?
Give thanks to the Lord.
Are you going
to
stand on the word of God? 347-663-8638.
If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know, love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all.
A few weeks ago, we were talking about the reprobate mind. And it's such a realistic conversation talking about the reprobate mind, because many people who preach the word and talk the word and operate in the church and do things contrary to God and do it in a so comfortable way, you can see the reality of the reprobate mind. That is what the Bible is talking about, a reprobate mind. The Spirit of God no longer confronts them about what they're doing that is contrary to the word of God, that is reprobate in your face, right there. You talk about reprobate right there in your alley, right in your house, reprobate to the key. Amen. Reprobate to get in the church and sing hallelujah, get home and play hip-hop music and soca music and everything just the same way. Reprobate mind, reprobate, ready for the gates of hell. Glory to the name of Jesus. Nobody could stop that. It's just the way it's going to be. Reprobate mind. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. We give him praise this morning. You're on your way to hell if that's the way you live. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. If that's the way you live, you're on your way to hell. You pray, don't die tonight before you repent. You're on the way to a fiery hell. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. You don't have to believe me. Hallelujah. Look at the word. Look at the word of God. Look at what he's saying. Amen. You're on your way to hell. If that's the way you live, hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. You don't want to die in that condition. Hallelujah. In that ungodly state of mind. Hallelujah. One foot in the church, one in the world. That is not going to work in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen and amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord.
1, 2.
Thank you, Lord.
5.
If you look around, you see it everywhere. The reprobate mind. Maybe your pastor is a reprobate.
If you are alone,
married and sleeping around with women in the church. Reprobate to the core.
You're not
ready for the pits of hell.
We're all the same. You need
a, and you know, people have a nerves that somebody die in that condition. They put up all kind of thing and say, he's gone to heaven, she's gone to heaven. I tell you. They say this person got to heaven. He's already with his father. Yeah, which father?
One,
which father?
See.
Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord this morning. He's worthy to be praised. His word shall not return void. It will accomplish that which he set up to do. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
When you feel afraid, you're not the only. We're all the same.
No one wants to get desensitized to the things of God. No man. It's the worst prayer. Nobody wants to reach that condition. When the Spirit of God no longer convicts you of unrighteousness. Nobody wants to get there.
Oh,
you couldn't wish that on your worst enemy.
Give thanks to the Lord.
we have no enemies. Christians should have no enemies. So we thank God for Jesus this morning, amen.
If you're rich or poor,
the number is 347-663-8638.
Weak or strong, in our love.
If you want to chime in. Talking about the counsel of the ungodly.
And he so loved the world to send his son to save a soul. And other people,
the Bible said they are like chaff,
oh,
which the wind drive it away.
The people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love.
What we're saying this morning, you have the power, you have the strength, you have life, you can do what is right. According to God, you can seek the face of the Lord, you can repent and come before God. If you're a part of these things that is contrary to the word of God, you can arise, you can separate yourself, you can save your soul today. It is not impossible. Hallelujah. Once you're willing to admit your fault and get into the face of God, God is a faithful God. Amen. Once you got life, there is hope. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. We give him thanks this morning. We thank him for his faithfulness. He continued to be a witness with us. Amen. Praise the Lord. He continued to be a witness with us. 347-663-8638. If you want to chime in this morning, we just want to raise the awareness. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Amen. If you're a child of God, you believe in Jesus, and you are walking, you are fellowshipping, you are counseling with people that is ungodly, living a contrary life to the word of God, you need to get up and make your move while you still have the opportunity. Because if you die in that predicament based on the word of God, it is impossible to see the face of the Lord. That caller, you can call me back. Don't be shy. Don't be intimidated. We understand this. We understand this. We know everybody's not going to go along. We understand this. The Bible said the coming of the Son of Man will be just like in the days of Noah. I believe it 100%. Amen. 8 people got saved in the days of Noah. Amen. Glory to the name of Jesus. And the same thing going to happen. Amen. The same thing going to happen. I don't care how we play this, how much churches we have, how much people we have, what we do. If we go contrary to the word of God, according to the Bible, we are going to perish. If we don't stand up for holiness and righteousness, and we don't strive to live according to the word of God, that we can bear witness of the light that is in us, we are going to perish according to the word of God. Caller, good morning to you. Thank you for your call. Thank you, caller. Go ahead. You're live. Listen to your phone, caller, not your radio. All right. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, I know that. I know that's the way it is. It's very hard to speak about. Because first of all, you're watching the evaluation of man, how people might recognize your voice and feel, well, who are you to play you holy or talk about holiness? But you, your Father know you. Your Father in heaven know you. You don't care what man think about you. You know what you want to do right according to the Lord. We're going to go through all kinds of things in life. But we know our focus is on Jesus. Our focus is on the truth. Our focus is on righteousness. So you can stand for the truth. You can stand for righteousness. Don't watch nobody. You're not holding no secret for nobody. You want to save your soul. You want Jesus Christ. And you're not going to stand for it. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Don't be shy, caller. You want to share? Don't be shy.
You are not alone.
Don't be shy if you want to share. Amen.
You are alone.
Like I said this morning, we want to raise up for those who feel that they are weak.
You're not the only.
They are less educated.
The
but they see things that is totally contrary to the scripture, totally contrary to godly life. And they don't know if they have the strength or the power to separate.
To
they might be undocumented and feel that somebody promised them something. So they must stick and stay with it. In the name of Jesus. Hell no, the devil is a liar. You need to rise up. Don't let no man hold you hostage in what is contrary to the word of God. God will provide. The same God you know is well able. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Let no man hold you hostage. Some people 10, 12 years claiming to be Christian, living unmarried. Don't want to marry. You will perish, brother and sister, if you die in that condition. God is not mocked. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God is no joke. No respecter of persons. Don't care who you think you are. That believer must make sure that they want to make their calling and their election sure according to the Lord. Give us a lot of grace period. We got to use those grace period. But there comes a time the door is shut. Enough is enough. Hallelujah. Walking in the counsel of the ungodly. Dwelling with them, laughing with them, smiling with them. Acting like you a dummy. Acting like you can't speak. Acting like your brain don't work. You will perish if you die in that condition. He said, to whom much is given, much is required. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. You will perish with all of them. With all the money.
And all the people said,
all the big building.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
And all the people said amen.
Whoa. Hallelujah.
And all
thank
the
you, Lord.
Said amen.
Whoa.
Give thanks to the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For it's never end. And all the people
thank
said
you,
amen.
Yes.
And all the people said amen.
Hallelujah. Jesus, hallelujah, Jesus, hallelujah, he's worthy. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
One, two, three,
hallelujah, four. Walking in the counsel of the ungodly, that is what we're talking about this morning. Everybody like it to be a show. Every Christian-oriented stuff is a show, just a show. Just talking stuff people want to hear.
One,
playing what they want to hear.
Three,
yes, while we continue with ungodly. Nobody knows if we're born again. Nobody know that we ever have something different in us. Nobody know. Our light is hidden. Hallelujah.
Two, three, four.
We all gonna perish. If that's the way we live. Believe it or not. God is not mocked. What a man sow, that shall he also reap. God is a fair God. Very just God. Let's give him praise. He is. Trust me. Yes, Lord. But we must seek righteousness in these closing days. It's our duty to shine our light before men. It's duty. It's our duty to call men out of darkness by what? Our light. Showing forth. That's why men are running from the church. When they get in there, they realize you're sicker than them. You're worse than them. Hallelujah.
You're not alone.
You're not alone.
If you are alone.
My brother or sister.
When you
thank you, Lord.
You're not the only. We're all the same. You need a mercy to be forgiven and be free.
Hallelujah.
It's all you got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen.
That's what the devil is doing. All the churches bringing all the dancing, all the dancers, all everything else, contrary to the scripture. To blind your eyes and blind your minds. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. No godliness, no holiness.
One, two,
thank you, Lord Jesus.
Five.
Talking about the praise dancing. Yeah, to who? Our God is holy. The Alpha and the Omega.
You are not alone. If you are lonely, when you feel
thank
afraid.
You.
Only we're all the same. You need a mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to leave.
The phone is still open.
God, it's all you.
And of course it's working.
And all the people said amen.
But I understand if you don't have to call.
Oh, and all the people said amen.
Thank you for listening.
Give thanks to the Lord.
Let this word marinate. Just know that you have the strength. God, ask him for the strength that he can move you on. He will give you. He said, those who diligently seek him will find him. And he means it. God is a faithful, awesome God. Whatever you want to do to honor God, if you ask him, he will give you the power.
God knows we stumble and fall.
But you got to take the first step.
Oh.
Let's go back to the phone. Caller, good morning to you. Grace and peace.
Good morning. Grace and peace to you.
Grace and peace to you, my brother. Thank you for your call. How are you doing?
I am fine today. Okay, let's get into the word here. Psalms 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Now, the writer begins this psalm by extolling the joy of being a godly person, one who obeys God and refuses to listen to those who discredit or ridicule him. Our friends and associates can have a profound influence on us, often in very subtle ways. If we insist on friendship with those who scoff at God's considered importance, we sin by becoming indifferent to God's will. This attitude is the same as scoffing. Do your friends build your faith up, or do they tear it down? The influence of true friends should draw you closer to God. God's blessing, in this same verse here, God's blessing results in joy. To obtain God's joy, the psalmist says we should avoid the company of mocking sinners. In addition, we should seek an understanding of God through his word. The shallow influence of mockers can separate us from the radiance of God's joyful presence, as a dark cloud separates us from the joyful presence of the morning sun. And if you want to go to verse 2, it says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. You can learn how to follow God by meditating on his word. Meditating means spending time reading and thinking about what you have read. It means asking yourself how you should change so you're living as God wants. Knowing and meditating on God's word are the first step towards applying it to your everyday life. If you want to follow God more closely, you must know what he says. Amen, brother?
Amen, my brother. Thank you for the call. Thank you for the commentary. And one thing I wanted to go back to, as he was reading one and he was talking, you didn't, when you spoke about not standing in the way of sinners, what the Spirit just revealed to me about this. If the sinner man see you not living a Christian life, you will cause him not to come, because you stand in his way to receive Christ. Because if you're not living godly, he cannot see God in you. You are causing the sinner man not to come to Christ. Amen?
Amen. That's why a lot of people are leaving the churches, and some of the churches are closing down. And a lot of churches, especially up in the East, have already turned to museums. And it's getting bad, because the Christians who are called Christians are not living according to God's word, because they're not meditating on God's word. You know, the society have influenced us to try to live, and this life is going to pass anyhow. You still have to live, but you have to put God first, and we're not doing that these days. We're turning to other things, trying to have a family and live our lives and forget about God and what he says. We're not meditating, and we're creating problems and hindrance for other people, putting stumbling blocks, so to say, before other people. Amen?
Amen, my brother. Thank you for the call.
Okay, God bless you.
Thank you, God bless you, yes. Six more minutes before the hour of 12. The Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. And you know, many times we might feel, oh, well, you know, God is not blessing me, God is not this. You got to watch your surroundings. Watch who is watering you. Watch who is feeding your roots. Watch who is your counsel. Watch who you're supporting. Watch who you are part of. And when I say supporting, I don't mean supporting like that. Watch who you are with. Watch who you is in your counsel. Watch who is feeding your brain. Watch who is feeding your mind. The Bible say, watch what you hear. What you hear will affect your faith. It didn't say what you hear might affect your faith. It say what you hear will affect your faith. Caller, good morning to you.
Hi, good morning. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, my sister.
Can you please take me off the air, please?
Well, we can do that after the segment is over. Call me when I'm finished the segment, okay?
Okay, very important. Thank you.
No problem. One, two, three, four. 5 more minutes to the top of the hour. Blessed is the man. It is crucial. God is the same God. God is not playing around. He said the coming of the Son of Man will be just like in the days of Noah. The Bible speaks of a time and latter time when many shall depart from the faith. How? Giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. All kinds of things contrary to Christianity is in the church now, creeping in, nothing to do with the Bible, nothing to do with God, nothing to do with Jesus, nothing to do with holiness, nothing to do with prayer, but all of us are involved in it. Everybody's involved in it. Everybody's going along with it. Amen. Caller, good morning to you.
Praise his name.
Praise his name, caller.
Yeah, I realize a lot of people are calling today. I think most of the people that are listening right now, they're scared, you know, because in the churches today, you know, it's like the ministers, sometimes they threaten the members, you know, because they have this, you know, spiritual strength, you know, obia. So if the people try to leave, they try to destroy their life. So because of that, a lot of people just stay in and sup up to all the foolish things that the ministers, those people that say they are ministers, but they are just robbers, you know, because they are all about offering, you know, to make them life better, you know. Because I've been to many churches and I saw the different behaviors. And I remember one time I go to this church and the minister was saying to me that, what do I do with my enemies? And I told her that in the Bible said, keep your friend close and your enemy close, him closer. So she said, what would I do to the devil? So I said, the devil is not my call. It's the God call. So she said she killed her enemies. And she's a bishop of a church. Okay, so what I realized, you know, I listened again and they said that whosoever leave here don't gonna go nowhere, like their life gonna be a mess. So what said that to say, a lot of people are scared. So if they're going to a church, I don't know what they dig themselves into, but they're scared of leaving and they're not gonna call in to say anything about the ministers because they're afraid the minister hear them and chastise them later. So you know, that's what is going on in the churches this day. You know, a whole lot of witchcraft, and it's all about how much money you could bring in to make, you know, the church run and to make the pocket bigger. You know, and when you look at even the mega churches, they're doing the same thing. They all about money. You know, robbing the people, telling them that if you put money in the, if you throw a seed, you're going to be blessed. And when I look at blessing, it's not only about money. Blessing is about many different things. You know, about your health, about strength, about the Holy Ghost, about your kids. Blessing school, bless in their job, blessed with their marriage, you know, a whole lot of different things about blessings. But these ministers, they try to preach only prosperity. They don't preach about rapture, you know. The other thing what they do, they don't teach the people to read the Bible, tell them to read that they could learn for themselves. Because everything is in the Bible for us to learn and understand God. But people, you know, like they wanted to hear what the minister says, so they don't really know about the Bible and what God said. The ministers now, they only teach the people what they want them to hear, so that they follow the things that they want them to hear and do the things that they want them to do. Then the mega ministers, they wrote a lot of different books. They're directing the people away from the Bible. So while people spending time reading their book, they should be spending time in the Bible, learning about God and the rules and regulation of His Word. So people need to get down more in the Bible and read a lot more, that they could understand what God want them to do. When the minister's telling a lie, they would know exactly, you know, to counteract it. And if that minister not doing the right thing, they would know, and they would choose to go to another church, or, you know, even if they're powerful enough in God, they could run their own church and teach people the right thing of God. So as I listen to your topic, I realize that nobody calling in because they fear, you know, somebody really hear the voice and you know, try to bring them up to the minister, that they fear. So as I sit around and look, we got to pray. We got to get down on our knees and pray, because the church is pushing away, you know, people. Because Jesus said He come not for the righteous, He come for the sinners. And if the sinners see that the church is not doing right, then the sinners gonna stay away from the churches, because the sinners out there seeking money, seeking a way how to survive. When they cannot make it, they go to God, because, you know, God sometimes chastises people to come to Him. So if they're going to come to the church broke because God chastising them, and the church says, okay, you know, you bring me up $1,000, you bring me up $200, and God going to bless you. You know that's not right, because God not gonna bless a person that He gonna chastise to come to worship Him. He have to do His term. He gotta follow what God told him to do until the day when he reached to that level for blessing, then God will bless him. So, you know, looking over all these things every day, and I said, if people never know that everything is in the Bible, read, pick up your Bible every day and read. If you cannot read, buy a tape and let it read to you, and you listen. Ask God for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding that you can understand the Bible. Okay, we understand it, because everything is in the Bible. That's nothing that happening on this earth is not in the Bible. Everything is in the Bible. People, read for yourself. Read for yourself. Ask God for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And He will. Hallelujah. Explain it to you, that no one will lead you astray.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Glory to Him, my brother. I thank you for calling. And I think as you spoke, you mentioned a lot of stuff. And the key element here that we're really trying to get at today is to give people the strength that they have what it takes to believe God, that God is going to move them from where they should not be, that they can seek God. Because if they see the thing that is wrong, they need to move away from it. That's why we're talking about, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. So how do they remove themselves from the ungodly? To seek the counsel of God, that He will give them the strength that they can move away from the ungodly and seek the face of the Lord. So thank you, my brother.
Yeah, you're welcome.
God bless you. Amen. 5 minutes past the 12. Thank you, caller. Very powerful and very potent. And listen, believers, the devil will definitely try to make you feel that all this thing that we're talking about here is boring. Why you don't go put some tape and listen to your own music? Or why you don't change to another station where they're just playing music and talking hallelujah, jump around for Jesus and all this kind of stuff like that. Because the devil wants to make sure you don't learn nothing, you don't know nothing, and in the ending, he's going to say, I got you. Amen. We got to stay diligent about the things of God, that is serious about the counsel of God, that we're going to make it to heaven. Amen. And like I said, it really hurt my spirit when a lady told me, old people talking about, you know, the pastor in the church or the deacon want to sleep with her and she don't know what to do and whispering in her ears. And I mean, I'm thinking, come on, a big woman. I mean, come on, big people have to know by now. You must have enough information. You must know by now. You in church for 20, 15 years. By now, you must know what God require. By now, we must know what God want. We must know what is conducive to holiness. We must know by this time, we must know. Amen. So we want to reach out to you and let you know you have the strength. You have what it takes to say, God, I want to do your will. I want you to show me what to do. Amen. I want to know. Amen. So this is what we're saying, because God is not going to condone. He's not going to aid and abet you when he give you the brain. He give you the wisdom to know that you can do it. Caller, good morning.
Praise the Lord. Good morning.
Praise the Lord.
I'm so really glad to hear this topic. I tuned in late this morning, and to my surprise, because this is something that needs to be brought out into the open, because we have to shame the enemy, the devil, and let him know that we're not going to be sitting behind the cross of silence. Because in the natural, people now, they come out about what's going on in the military and women being, you know, sexually harassed and various different things. And it is about time that we as Christians have to put aside, it's that fear thing, you know, because for many years I've been saved and serving the Lord, and I have come against every evil thing that has been, that man in the natural could do. And I can say with all honesty that there weren't any horrible things that happened to me in terms of male-female relationships, superiors in the world that happened to me in the church. And so this is what has happened. It's happening as we speak. And even now when you mention it to people, when you notice something wrong, many times the sisters will call and voice their opinion, you know, and let you know what's going on, or you may be fellowshipping with them, and they just burst out and tell you. And this is the absolute disgusting truth about what is happening today. And because they have became comfortable, because we have friendships, you know, over the years you develop what you think are bonds and friendships, but you know, it's not a bond that you think. It's not a healthy bond. It is bondage, because the enemy now has you hoodwinked in there that makes you so afraid that if you leave, where will you go? What will you do? But the absolute truth is that if you stay, you risk losing everything that God had for you. You risk not being able to accomplish the plan and the purpose that God has for your individual life. And you're fooling yourself. Once you make, today you're hearing something. And today is the day that you have to make a decision who you will serve. You have to say to yourself, it is true that I have been seating in the council of the ungodly. I have been taking ungodly counsel. I have been being led by ungodly people. And I have been uncomfortable in this situation, but it is fear that has paralyzed me and keep me here. The only way you will get the Holy Spirit to operate in your life is you have to come out first. Faith is an act. You have to come out first. You have to finally say, you know what? I can't come in here another day. I cannot pay my tithe in here. I cannot fellowship in here. How can a man or a woman stand up and say anything to you from the Bible when the night before he is asking you for sexual favors. How is that even possible? If your doctor did something to you inappropriately, you wouldn't go back there. If your instructor did something to you inappropriately, spoke inappropriately or acted inappropriately, you would not go back there. But yet, week after week, sometimes 2-3 times a week, and then when you do all the extra things that, you know, churches do that have nothing to do with God, you're involved. So there comes the point now. This is the day, I believe, that the Lord has set aside this time, because it is about time. Because, Minister Straker, they may not be really necessarily telling you, but I'm telling you, they tell me. And they whisper, and they get together, and they wring their hands, and they fret, and they talk amongst themselves what to do. And then they just act as if they're delusional that it doesn't really happen, because how you have to really admit it's happening, and it's happening to you, and that you're not going to put up with it in order for you to come out. You see? And then you have the friends around you who are saying, well, you know, sister, that's how he is. You know, just pray for them, whatever it may be. That is not so. The Bible clearly says not to sit in the seat and the counsel of the ungodly. And he says to come out from among them and be ye separate. He says come out. Come out is the first thing. Come out. He doesn't say stay in there and see what I'll do. He says come out from them and be ye separate. You separate yourself by removing yourself. You take your physical self and you don't enter into those doors again. And you believe God that you're going to find a place, a nice, healthy God where they're preaching the uncompromised word of God to go and be spiritually fed. You cannot be spiritually fed by a person who has a sin problem, a lust problem, or maybe having demonic infestation. You don't know. You don't know. Most of the times it's the flesh. But in any way, state, shape, or form, it is ungodly and it is filthy. It is... You know, I don't know how much you can't, it is just filthy. It's filth, and it's happening right there. So, yes.
Hello, are you there?
Amen, yes. So, you know, we have to just stand up. We have to not be afraid and don't be ashamed, you know. Because, Minister Straker, I had a very similar situation all through the years. And I can tell you that, there was a very recent encounter I had 2 or 3 years ago. And I went to the leadership. Well, I was going to speak to the person first. And then what happened is actually I felt the person had so kind of, well, threatened me, you know, to say, did you say anything about me? Did you say anything? Because I had said I was going to come to the office and speak to him. But then I thought better of it, that I really didn't want to be alone with this person because this person was making sexual advances to me. Had the audacity to want to, the person is in charge of a pantry and wanted to exchange food for sexual favors. It happened to me. I'm saying it openly. I was in a situation, you know, out of work, and I had to take in some homeless people, and I needed to go to the pantry. And this person took advantage, but doesn't know, you know, like I said, doesn't know that I'm born again, doesn't know anything about me, and really absolutely made sexual advances and then told me that he can do such and such for me. I wouldn't even have to be on the line if we can get together.
Is the person saved? I mean, is the person a Christian? I mean,
the person. Well, Minister Straker, you really have to say to yourself, I can just tell you this. The person is a deacon in the church and has a responsibility of running the food pantry in the church. Hands out Holy Communion. Gets up and says, thus saith the Lord, in the church. Well, an old timer. Okay, we're not talking about young people, not that I would excuse, but as it was said, these are people up in their 70s, okay? It is a disgrace. It makes me want to vomit, I'll tell you the truth. And I did speak to, now I had a few close friends because I was doing some ministry works inside that place too, and I spoke to some leadership. My dear, it was not taken very well, and it was kind of
dismissed. And then, you know, a lot of things were going on. At that time, I was not as mature as I am today. You know, we're talking about 4 or 5 years ago, 2, 3 years ago, because things happen, you know, different places, different times. So this, if anybody tells you that, and it's the worst because you're telling them about them, and they know things are going on too. And they go, oh, really? And they make you feel like they want to intimidate you. They make you feel like you're nuts, that you're imagining it. And, you know, you're the new person on the block. So, of course, now, you know, you come in there just to start trouble. Here we are in our nice, comfortable church, and here comes this one. And she wants to come in here now and raise a ruckus and start all kind of nonsense, okay? And then they find all kind of excuses, you know. If you're not from where they're from, if you don't think like them, if you don't do things like them, well, that's the reason. And then now you are, you're the victim, but now you are the person who's in there starting the trouble because nobody wants to go against that person. And you know why? Not only because they have friendships in there and all that, and they've been together for years. A lot of people are family members with one another, and they get favors because a lot of the times, if a person has, you know, sometimes in ministry, there are people, what they call, grease each other's palm, you know, and there's stealing going on inside. If I have a bookstore, I wish they would go and get the books, you know, really. If I have a bookstore, I'm going to give you these things free. If I have a clothing store, I'm going to give these things for you. You're going to give me that, and we're all going to keep our mouths shut, and they kind of intimidate and badger the person who is rising up against the fight because nobody wants to shake up anything. Everything is fine. Everybody's happy. And it's absolutely truth, and it has to stop. And people have to stand up. I do openly talk to people now. I do talk about the things that now the Lord is bringing to light, and I am not well received. As of day before yesterday, not well received. People either lie and say you're imagining it or it can't be or are you sure that's what happened? You know, they make you feel like you're the one. Or they'll say, well, you know, I know that's going on, but listen, you know, some don't have much time. Look at the analogy. Listen, I don't care what they do in there. You know what? You know what, sister? I go there. I pay my tithe. I just go there and worship the Lord. I don't care what they do. I don't let this person in my home. I don't eat with them. I don't da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And yet they sit there and sit there and sit there, and we are talking a long time. We're not talking about people who got saved yesterday. Because you know what I believe? People who are newly saved would be more, you know, because they're just coming out of the world, you would be more quicker. You would be quicker to say, oh, what kind of nonsense is that? This is what happened to me when I was in the world. Now I come in here. No, this can't be. Maybe they would be quicker to leave even too than the old folks, you know, that have been going there forever and ever and don't want to make a stand because they feel the price is too high. If they're going to make a stand, that means they lose everything. If they happen to have a ministry of helps in there, they're going to be put out. They won't be allowed. Well, when they come back to church now, the next Sunday after they speak out, they're going to face so much hatred and so much eyes and so much that they're not, you're not going to be welcome. So now you feel that you're going to be all alone, and especially if you're a senior, it really seems to be harder because, you know, you're set in your ways and people say, well, when we're older, we don't make friends so easy, whatever excuses. But all of that, what I have just spoken, these last things here, is a lie, a filthy lie from the pit of hell. Because the same God that saved you, also, if you express to him, Lord, it is not my will nor my desire to be part of this. I would rather just sit with you and read my Bible and go and visit different places and hear the word. Put on the radio and go and go and try the Spirit. You may have to go to a few different places to see that the Holy Spirit is being taught there, being led there, excuse me, leading. But you cannot stay where you are. So to the question you asked me, is this person saved? Well, I would have to say, how can you truly be a servant and a follower of Jesus Christ if, in my opinion, you are doing worse than the man who doesn't know God out there? You cannot be saved. No, you cannot be saved. You're pretending to be saved, and you have your buddies inside there who are winking at what you're doing because it gives them a personal gain. Nobody wants to stand up. You know what I would love to hear from folks? Years ago, any little funny thing rise up in a person in the church, they were counseled and they were asked to sit down. If you had a ministry of any kind, if you're in there and you're in the ministry of helps, and you act unseemingly, depending on how egregious the affront is, the leadership would get together and discipline you, and then counsel you. Yes, you repent and you get forgiven, but you certainly cannot be fornicating all over the place. Have a wife. In my case, this person had a wife, and let me tell you how good God is. The person has a wife, and I directly said to him, because the person had asked me out first, asked me to go on a date, so I said, are you married? And he said, no. So he didn't start out his nonsense at the very beginning. But God is so good that I had gone to church that very next week, and the pastor got up and asked us to pray for this particular person because his wife is sick in a nursing home in another country. So he was a married man to boot. So, you know, when you sit down and you really start to think about these things, you know, the filth nature of it. And the sad story is, Minister Straker, it is sad, but it's natural truth that we become desensitized. It's like you hear gunshots. First time in my life, I was like, oh, you know, I was all panicked. Now you hear the gunshots and you used to go out and put out the garbage. You're not thinking that, you know, you hear the helicopter overhead. You see, it's like living in a war zone. You become so desensitized. It does not offend you because you have allowed yourself to become complacent with the sin. You have not constantly renewed your mind and say to yourself, how filthy this is. And in that particular church, the filth is so bad that the other departments, it's nonsense going on there too. They have a book reading club, and you think you're going to be reading Christian material, you're not. It's secular books, and they have people leading those book reading clubs that are not born again, not spirit-filled, and they are professionals in other arenas, and they're giving you their professional opinion that has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. And so they encourage you in the things of the world. They encourage you to say, well, you know, sometimes it's good for people to have an affair, because then that will teach the other person that they shouldn't mess with you, so to speak. You know, it even grieves me to speak about it, Minister. I have to honestly tell you, I'm talking to you and I just feel like crying, because, you know, it's just filth. It's just filth. And I can say this because it's absolute, the truth of what's going on today. And also, I can say unequivocally, in my personal life, no man in the world, no matter where they're from, no matter what they believe in, if they worship a stone, if they're on drugs, if they're alcoholics, if they're mentally deranged, if they're emotionally disturbed, no man has ever touched me inappropriately, disrespected me, spoke to me in a disgusting manner, used words that I never even heard in my life that I had to learn what they mean, until I went into the church. And I say that with all reverence. And I just say it because I want people to stop. Listen, you can't make the person stop. You have to come out. You can't make the person stop. Now, it would be scriptural if you would go and speak to that person. But I'm telling you, if you have somebody who's touching you and menacing you and cursing, you know, using words, cursing you, you cannot be alone with that person. It would not be wise. So, because, you know, ultimately what I wanted that person to be restored. And my intention was to go and speak to that person privately and restore that person and show them the error of the ways. But when I bumped into that person in the street and they it was a threatening, like, you know, the way they spoke to me, I said, oh, no, that's not wise for me to be alone, you know, with that person to say things to them. So ultimately I left. And because I left, you know, the Lord has opened up other doors for me. But yes, Minister Straker, it goes on as we're speaking. And it is really horrible. You know, if you have an opportunity to ever be like the undercover boss, if you go into a church and stay a few months and don't let anybody know too much that you're saved, they wouldn't know. They'd have to come and ask you. You know, the funny thing is, I went to that church for a good while, and nobody asked me if I was saved, you see? That should be the first thing when you come into the church. Hello, how are you? You know, how'd you find out about us? Do you know Jesus Christ? So they may not ask you, but you say yes if you want. You know, yes, I'm saved.
As you're saying that, they, and this is something I see with many things that claim to be ministry. If you are ministry and you're seeking soul, why are we not hearing the salvation prayer? Why are we not asking people? You don't know who's saved and who not saved. And a lot of ministries go along like that. They just do their service, do their thing like it's their own little group. They come and sing and dance and everybody just go home. They don't care who come new, who saved, who not saved, who want to reunite with Christ, who having a, you know, whatever it is. And all those things that we can look at to know who is really doing ministry or who is just having a club. Do you know what I mean? Hallelujah.
Well, that's
amen.
What it is. It's a club. And all you have to do is show up somewhere a few Sundays, anywhere, pick any place. There's every other doorway is a church. I can honestly tell you, you know, they're few and far between. You know, there was a day in some churches it was so lovely that the pastor would say, please turn to the person next to you. I like that. Turn to the person next to you and say, are you born again? Have you accepted Christ as your Savior? And then encourage them, walk up with them, you know? Say, well, I'll go with you. You know, would you like to accept Christ? I'll go with you. You know, and that's so sweet, and it works very nicely. And then you see what happens once you grow up with that person and they accept the Lord. Then you kind of feel like you're a spiritual mom or dad, and then you kind of keep your eye on that person. You know, encourage them. If you find, you know, when they have Bible study, make sure you invite them, see how they're doing, pay attention to them. It's very nice, you know.
But you can be going
places years and years and years, and if you hear an altar call, praise the Lord. And if anybody is really concerned particularly about you personally, about how's your spiritual growth? Because you'll be outside the churches and people are smoking around the corner. And they don't even come and address that, you know. And, you know, I mean, you know, oh, Minister Straker, you know, I tell you, it is a topic that needs to be addressed. And then, you know, you address it. And now how is it supposed to work, Minister Straker? You speak it out. You speak the truth. You speak the word of God. You got scripture to back up what you say. You give them the scripture. Now, this is would be my thing. How many of us now, we've heard something right now. Tomorrow is the day that we gather and go into the churches and the places to come, so we say. Now, how many of us, knowing that these things are going on, are going to go right back tomorrow morning to the same place where all this nonsense is going on? Now, it would be very wonderful if you would go, if you have you yourself, or you have a few people, because usually if you know it, you have your close friends, they know it too. If it happened to you, like when the thing happened to me, about 10 people knew it. And one was the pastor's wife, the other was the pastor's son, and two other pastors and leaders in the church, they knew it. And a couple of brothers and sisters, they knew. And so you'd have to say, well, can you come with me and let us go and address this? They won't go with you. Very few will go. So what you have to do, you have to come out. You yourself, you have to save yourself. You have to come out. Whatever choice do you have, how are you going to handle this? You can make a phone call, you can write a letter, but you yourself have to come out because it's terrible. And so, you know, and then, you know, it was funny when I was telling, now this is how it goes. I have had a very close brother in the church, and I was talking to him about it, and he stayed quiet for a while. And about 4 or 5 months later, we were talking, and he said to me, well, I guess my wife was telling the truth then, he said. And he said he used to tell me about that particular person, and I didn't really believe her because it was his good friend. And they're from the same place. And he said, my wife was telling me the truth, he said. Look at that. Okay? And my wife is telling me the truth, and still I'm still going to that church. And he's one of the people that said to me, listen, sister, I just go and, you know, I just serve the Lord, and I don't pay attention. I go in and I come out. You see what I mean? It's exactly what happened to me, 100%.
Hallelujah.
And I'm quoting exactly what was said to me. I'm not exaggerating at any point. So this is what you have. So you have to have the strength and the courage to come out. And it may not seem easy, but God will never leave you. He'll make a way for you. Does God love me more than he loves Susie? No. God made a way for me. I had to come out when it was probably the most hardest time of my life. I'm thinking I'm going to lose where I'm living or be homeless. I had no income, none, zero, zip, nothing, no food. and I had taken in a homeless woman before I had lost my job. But what am I going to do now? But I could not stay there. So I said, well, I'd rather sit in here. No heat. No heat. I didn't have money to put oil in the tank. Freezing in the apartment. And I had to come out from there, where at that time would have been where I thought I could get some help, you know, and get some counseling of what to do and what different channels to go. It was my first experience, you know, in certain areas. I had faced some certain problems in my trials, I guess. It was not problem trials. But the Lord has delivered me, and he did make a way, absolutely made a way. And I knew no lack during those years. But I'm saying that look at my situation, and other people at this exact moment that we're speaking, they are in a better situation. They're in a warm place. They have food. They have a some sort of income coming in, and you don't have to be intimidated and fearful. You have to leave. You cannot sit there anymore.
Hallelujah.
Because you're not serving God. What are you doing in there?
No, you're not serving God.
You're not
God,
serving God, and not, God is not getting the glory in there. Nothing is happening. You, as a matter of fact, I will go as far to say to you, you know what? You pick up your 2 feet and go to a dance hall and go to a bar on a Saturday night and sit down there. Somebody will treat you better. You're not serving God anyway. What difference does it make? And you can have a more pleasant conversation and laugh and eat and come out. You're in there. You're fooling yourself. You think that you're all right. You're not all right. And it's not good. It's horrible. I don't know how many words I can use to describe it. It's debauchery, evil, demonic. The people are not. You cannot. Listen, you can be saved and be immature. Yes, because even now, I'm a seasoned citizen, and I'm learning so much myself as I read again the word. But for all that is holy, there is no way that you don't know that you can't have sex with other women when you're not married. Even the heathen knows that. There's no religion on the face of the earth that tells you that that's, well, even the Muslims, they have to have wives. You can't have girlfriends, you see. So there's no place where you can know that cheating on your wife is all right in any way. So who are you kidding? Stealing, lying, cheating. You're doing all that. And because you get dressed up and you have a Bible, you think it makes it all right. You're a liar. You're a liar.
Hallelujah.
You've been lied to, and you've received the lie. You've accepted it. You've made it your religion. And that's what you do on Sunday. And oh, the Bible says, woe. Woe unto the shepherd that leads the flock astray. Woe to the leaders that preach not the truth of this gospel of Jesus Christ. Woe. Woe unto you. You older women and men who the Bible says you're to teach the younger ones in the how to love, how to walk circumspectly, how to walk decently and in order, how to carry themselves like the beautiful, glorious vessels of honor that God created them to be. But you go in there, whenever you go in there, and you are so easily, turn to the left and turn to the right and being bamboozled and lied to, and they come. I mean, it's Satan in there himself,
and
sitting in there.
Not to cut you off, but as you're just saying that just came in my spirit, you know. And there are many people who support ministry because somebody is their brother or sister or something to do with their family, and they will still and condone what is wrong, contrary to the word of God, because it's their brother or sister or their son or their daughter or their father or whatever, and they stay right there. They're going to go to hell with that just the same way. God is not going to condone that. Amen? God is not going to condone that.
If they die in that, yes, because if you die without repentance, because look, they're not repenting, they would have come out. When I really got hold of this thing, you know, so it knocked me for a loop a little bit, Mr. Straker. I'm telling you the truth. I was saying, like, no, that and myself, I said, is that what he was saying? And then, you know, when I really came and I really, really thought about it, you know, and I said, that's exactly what he's saying. And then I saw him a few other times, of course. And then when he saw me, now, he came to understand, you know, I didn't just fall off the pumpkin truck yesterday. When I came into the lobby, he starts saying, oh, there you are. Praise the Lord. I knew when I met you, sister, you were a woman of God. If you were to hear him, you know? And you know something, Minister Straker? He deserved a slap in his face. That's what he deserved. Okay, for what he did and said, okay? I would have been justified, okay? And that is absolutely true. And then, you know, I didn't do anything wrong. All I did was go to get food on the food line. But I'll tell you, I said, oh, Lord, forgive me. You know, I was checking myself. Was I dressed okay? Did I do something? You know, I want to check myself out first. I repented, and I prayed, ask God to forgive him. You know, I did what I knew to do. But when I really said, oh, no, you can't be in there. And, you know, I was shocked because I didn't know. I didn't understand a few things, you know. And I had my head down one day. They were giving out communion. When I looked up, there he was, having the audacity, the gall, the nerve to hand me communion. Oh, Minister Straker, you know, I felt bad for me, but I have to tell you, I came home and cried so much about Jesus because I said, can you imagine he died for that. He died for that person. And look what that person is doing. And so blinded. You know, I said a few things to him, and he just let me know that he is in charge there, and nobody can move him, nobody can touch him. He was so full of pride. In no way, shape, or form did he even feel convicted by what I was speaking. And he's not the first. And I could name, off the top of my head, 10 right now. He's not the first. And that would be in the last 5 years. He's not the first, and he's not the only.
And that was a deacon.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Yeah. We thank you for the call this morning. Go ahead.
All right, my
brother. Go ahead.
And thank you. You know, and thank you for bringing it out, because, you know, Minister Straker, I will say this. When these things happen to us, and I say me because it happened to me, I had nowhere to go but to the Lord. Because, you know, if somebody comes and touches you unwarrantedly, it is battery. If I in the world, you know, you report to the police, that person could be arrested for assaulting you, and it's battery. Now, in the church, they do all kind of things, and it's swept under the rug, you see? Now, how come in the military we talk about these things happen, or in the hospital, in the police force, whatever large gathering, you know, whatever, you know what I mean? People do things. People in position do things. And we cry out, and we want all kinds of law. But inside the church, who do we go to? So that's what I'm saying to you. I thank God for Choice Radio. And I thank God because the Lord knew you. You have to have holy boldness to come forth, and because you're the iron that sharpens me, I have holy boldness now too. I don't care what anyone thinks of me. I'm going to speak the truth. I don't care, because I have tried and proved my Lord and Savior. He has done me well. He has kept me. And we're speaking it out to condemn the sin, but restoration is there. I don't hate the person. I feel extreme pity, and I pray for those people. When it comes to mind, sometimes, you know, the pain of it comes to mind. I bind it. I speak to myself, you know, and I pray for that person. And we don't know what happened to them now. We don't know what position they're in now. I pray to God that they repent. But to those that are hearing today, heed the word of the Lord. It is the word of God speaking. But Minister Straker, I don't want to speak for you, but I would take a guess and say, I can speak for myself too. We would much rather do things and happy and praise the Lord and sing and enjoy ourselves than have to keep starting over from zero and going back to basics and telling people, no, you cannot have sex in the church. No, you cannot steal in the church. No, you cannot lie in the church. No, when you're in there and you say you're a church, you have to preach the uncompromised word of God. Isn't it late? But yet it need be said. So Hallelujah. God bless you. I am so grateful to God. And to Minister Straker, thank you. Thank you. Thank God. Because, see, I have my day in court today, and I needed it because I have kept it in for many years. And I'm thankful that I had a chance to say, yes, this happened to me. And bless the Lord, because he has done me well.
Amen. In Jesus' name. Thank you for the call.
All right, dear. Bye-bye.
39 minutes on the other side of the 12 indeed. Very serious and potent conversation this morning. We're talking about Psalms 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. And there's a Joshua 24:15. He said, and if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve. Whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord Jesus. And the Bible said in Matthew 18:15, if you see your brother or your sister sin a sin,
you are not alone.
Go point out the fault.
If you are lonely, when you feel afraid, you're not the only. We're all the same.
347-663-8638 if you have a comment this morning.
And be free.
And I know one of the things that is deeply rooted in our culture, in our wherever we are coming from, we always feel that we are not capable of doing something. And especially when it comes to holiness and righteousness, everybody going to feel, I don't think I'm good enough to say this. I don't feel somebody going to look at me and feel, well, who do I think I am? Well, if you could always, well, so then who is it? If nobody can get it, then who is it? If nobody can stand up on the side of the Lord, then who can? Amen. Caller, good morning.
Good morning, Pastor. I just like to say thanks to the previous caller. I'd like to tell her that I do appreciate her. I don't know her, but I listen to the radio stations in the morning. And most times that she comes on, and she has been a blessing. And I do really, really appreciate the thought that she had this morning. It really touched me in a lot of ways, because there are some of the things, experiences that she shared that was my experience also. And it happened when I was like a young Christian in my teens, and the shame of it and the fact that people in the church did not believe you, and people in the church, like I remember the pastor, when I went to complain to him, he called me the biggest liar and told the other young people not to speak with me. So
wow.
I've had my experience, yes. And I am very, very grateful that she came on the air this morning and spoke about it so eloquently. God bless her.
Thank you for your testimony also. Amen. Thank you.
You're most welcome.
All right. 12:43, the Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Regardless to what people make you feel and who make people try to paint you to be less than worthy of God, less than worthy of the things of God, you have to say, the devil, you a liar. Amen. I know who God made me. I know what I believe about Jesus. I know what I believe about Christ. I know what my mind projection is towards the things of righteousness, towards the things of God. Amen. And the laws of God are not grievous, and we could do it. He wouldn't tell us we could do it if we cannot do it. Amen. We could do it. We could do this, said the Lord, regardless to what we are facing, what we are going through. We could live according to the word of God. We could live according to the standard of the word of God. But however, the devil will try to make you feel that no one is worthy. So let's just all get along and have a nice party and do it, whatever, woo ha ha, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. But it does matter. Amen. In the name of Jesus, the Bible calls for holiness. Psalms number one, look at the strategic location of that Psalms number one. Psalms number one is, that's where everybody go for strength. That's where every believer in Christ go for strength. Have you read number one before you move to whatever it is that you read to fight against your enemy, or to plead to God for whatever it is? Have you read number one? Because that's how God works. He put that one in a strategic place to understand before you reach here. It's the same way, like he said, before you come to the altar, make sure you take your business first. Make sure before you come before me. Don't come before me unless you go and take care of business before you come to me. It's the same way that God orchestrates his stuff, that we will make sure that we are right with him, that we can walk in the full counsel of the word of God. Amen. Hallelujah. And we don't care what people say. It shouldn't be a thing where you care what people say. You couldn't care what people talk about you, because you didn't know. You have to make sure that you're going to do it according to the Lord, because God is the same God, and you are going to perish. We are going to perish if we don't line up with the word of God. That's why the Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. If the ungodly, let them know, I'm not going to walk. I'm not going to be a part of this. If this is not of God, I will not submit myself to that kind of counsel. In the name of Jesus. Let's go back to the phone caller. Good morning to you. Grace and peace to you for your call. Grace and peace.
Good morning.
Morning. Listen to your phone, not your radio. Go ahead.
Yes, good morning, Pastor. Yeah, the sister that not the sister the sister that called before the last sister, may God ever bless her, because I'm going through a situation, just the situation that she said, right here now, and I'm being accused that I'm making trouble, but I just know that God never fails, and I'm just waiting on Him, and I believe in Him, and I know there's no secret what He can't do. Because the spiritual life that we have, children of God, supposed to be living in the church, not one church around the world, what I realize, we are not at His requirement. And if you go and say something, they bash you, and you come in the church and you want to like run and go over them. But I am thinking about my soul and other soul on the outside. And I need, by the grace of God, to make it. So, as that sister had said, whatever she just said, all of what's been going on in Christendom, and all my desire is to just live for Him and keep on praying and fasting, and let He open my eyes to send me on the right track. So may God bless you for the topic, and the topic need to be, not for tonight, today alone. I think this topic needs to be going on for maybe another 2 or 3 months. That we can get it together with children in Zion. We need to get it together. Because God's requirement is holiness unto the Lord.
Amen.
Thank holiness, you. Not unto man, not unto this person, not unto the brother, unto the Lord. Holiness unto the Lord. So yeah. Please pray for me. I'll pray for you.
In Jesus' name. Thank you for the call. In Jesus' name. Amen. And young lady, let me say this to you as we continue to counsel according to the word of God. In the Bible, it speaks of making a righteous judgment. Mark 7 and 1:1-3. It speaks about judge lest ye be judged. And many times people bring that to your face and try to make you feel guilty. But the Bible is very specific. He said, judge lest ye be judged. It means if you are correct in your judgment, go ahead, make that judgment, because you have all the evidence to back up what you're saying. If they are living contrary to the word of God, you can totally make that judgment if you have all the evidence to back it up based on how they live, how they walk, how they talk. You have your evidence. So many times people throw that in your face and say, judge, lest he be judged. The Bible says you could make a judgment, but the Bible said to also rightly divide the word of truth. He said to judge lest ye be judged. Do not judge lest ye be judged. That means if you make a judgment and you're wrong, this person can come back and show you that the truth of what you're saying, and then you're going to look bad. But if what you're saying is true, then you have all reason to shout it from the mountaintop, shout it from the housetop if it's true and contrary to the word of God. Amen. So we must continue to abide in the word of God, because the word of God defends itself in every application. Amen. So we just want to say this because we want to really today influence those who feel that they're weak. Many people feel sometimes, you know, you live by somebody, or they're the one that brought you to America, or they're the one that helped you with certain things that you were dealing with. You feel some obligation to them. You feel you must do this for them. And even in the church, it happens that way. People feel that, well, I came in, and when I was young, this is what happened, and they christened my child, or this, or that, or that, or that. So whatever wrong that they do, you feel you can condone it with them. You can stand with them. That's a lie from the pit of hell. You need to stand up for what is right according to the word of God. And this is what we're speaking about this morning. We want to give you that strength to let you know you will choose this day whom you will serve. Amen. And this is what we're calling for. The Bible is very clear. It said, blessed is the man that seated not. He walketh not. He seated not. Amen. In the counsel of the ungodly. Amen. So this is what we're dealing with. If you're already this morning and you want to share with us, You know what I mean? And many people go through this thing. They go to church and they want to know, why am I even here? There is not no God in here. There is no spirit of God here. There is nothing godly going on here. There is nothing righteous. There is nothing holy going on here. There is nothing truth going on here. Why do I subject myself to that kind of thing? Why am I doing this? And the Bible tells you to get out from among them. Hallelujah. Get out from among them. That is what he's saying. He's seen a sin, you tell him. He don't want to move away from it, you move away from it and move and make yourself right with God, because God will honor you. Caller, good morning to you.
Praise the Lord, Minister Stryker. How
praise
are you?
Praise the Lord. In Jesus' name, I'm great.
Praise God. Praise God. Yes, I believe that that's why we have the Holy Spirit. And like you said, to make a righteous decision, and our spirit is to be a witness. So we can't sit into a church and see things going on, and we just stay there. I remember when the topic came up about selling in church. And yes, I read the scripture, Jesus turned over the table because they were selling into the temple. And I used to see they will announce what is on sale at church, but we have the downstairs where they will buy. That's where they exchange the money and everything. But after I hear that topic, my soul was not comfortable with the whole thing about announcing it in the sanctuary, and then they go downstairs and buy. And then one Sunday, someone was actually selling inside the church, and I tell the person, no, not in here, take it outside or go downstairs, not in here. And the person who was buying the product says, I'm not taking the product, I'm just sponsoring, giving a donation. I said, no, exchanging the money in here, and it's not for the offering, take it outside. And the person went to my mom and said, your daughter just rebuked me. And this is the thing, we as children of God, we have to stand up for the word of God. As long as you receive it and the Lord show you this, you get this in your spirit, you don't move on anymore. And the church that I lived before, the usher was after me. And I was pregnant. And this guy know I'm pregnant. The big belly is there. And you're still giving me words and saying this child should be yours. And what is wrong with you? And I had to put him in his place. I didn't go to any minister or anybody and say anything. But I spoke to him and I put him in his place. And based on that church, I'm not bashing any church, but I was looking for growth. I went there, and that's where I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. My children got christened in that church. But I wanted more. And it's when I was listening to Choice Radio, I see that there's a way to live. But when I was in the church, I was just holy on Sunday, and then my life was a mess during the week, and my soul just couldn't handle that. My spirit just couldn't handle that, and that's when I moved, because I actually feel like I could just do anything I want in that church, and that's when I moved on. But anywhere you go, the Bible tells you there's a seat for Satan in every church. They're not going to run to and fro, but make sure your spirit is bearing witness to what is going on. And if it's nothing that you cannot talk about or whatever, move on. Because you cannot sell your soul to the devil after in church for so long. Just go outside and live it up, if so be it. But if you're serving God, stand for him 100%. And this is what children of God, have to do if we want to meet him in heaven. Holiness is the way to Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you very much, my sister. And as you're on the phone, as you was mentioning, God is saved in a church, and you felt some sort of obligation to be there. As Hebrews 4:12 says, for the word of God is alive and sharp and active like any two-edged sword. Once the word of God come to you and your heart is humble and submissive to God, you will receive Christ and you could be born again by the word of God being preached to you. But then what God hopes is that we are going to grow. And when we start to grow and develop, if we don't have the right nutrients, we don't have the right watering in our soul, then we get stagnated. So as much as we receive Christ, then we cannot grow. So we need to seek the milk, that will continue to grow us. We need to seek food that we can eat. So God, you could receive Christ one place, but God don't want you to stay one place if you're not going to grow. You need to move and continue to seek the sincere meat of the word. Amen. So
amen, amen. Uh-huh. And that's the thing, Mr. Strico. Mm-hmm. We all believe that, okay, once people, I'm not going to say we, because I know it's more than accepting Jesus Christ. He said, study to show yourself approved. That means you have to grow. You have to come off the milk and start biting on bones, you know, solid food. So we have to keep on staying in the word of the word of God. He says, a light unto our feet and a lamp unto our path. That means every single thing we do, we should make sure it line up with the word of God. And that's just how this lifestyle is. And you have to know that this is what you want. You have to want the end result. Salvation, meeting the Lord, having fun in glory land, see him riding on the cloud. You know, I mean, Minister Straker, I thank God for Choice Radio, Minister Straker, because even when I was in that church, I thought that, yes, I'm glad I started there, because God will put you anywhere just to start you off. And it put me right there, and I thank God for the day I went in that church. I never stopped from that day, Minister Straker. And I just want more of Jesus. I just want more of him, because I know this is not where it stops.
And my sister, as you're speaking there, something just came back to my spirit right there. I remember when I just got saved in the beginning, for some reason, the leader never really take me. You know, like somebody just know that this person is a troublemaker. This is going to be some trouble. Like, I'm endorsing this, but this is good, not going to go the right. Because, you know, sometimes somebody could just look at you or listen to you and just say, this person look like this is going to be a trouble. You know, this thing is not going to work out. Because I was always kind of suspect in the sense that because the kind of way I when I got into God and the seriousness and the way I was just about, you know, just seeing things right and seeing things go according to what I'm reading in the Bible, people were kind of looking at me like, this guy kind of, you know, kind of going to rock the boat. You know, it's like, he kind of get into, you know, because I went to a barbecue one time and I saw them, they were playing a few Christian songs for us. Then they started playing the worldly song. It was around Labor Day time and they were playing the regular songs. I'm thinking, you know, and I start showing my discomfort, and somebody will start feeling like, man, this guy looks like he's going to try to rock the boat, you know. This is going to, you know.
Sound like me.
Yes, people look like this guy, you know, he's not going to go along with the flow, you know what I mean? So the same thing we're trying to say, you might feel obligated to somebody because they're a family member, they are married to their family, something happened, they pay whatever, or you feel they have helped you in some way to help you get your papers, or they might help you get a job, or they might help you whatever. So you feel obligated to these people because they have done something for you. So you feel you must stay with them, don't care how down they go in terms of God, you feel obligated. But we're trying to let you know, you couldn't care less. Your God is more than able. You have to let them know, I'm going to stand on the word of God. I don't care what you say. I'm not going to support what you're doing. I'm not about that. And this is what God is hoping, that his children will stand for him.
Yes, our eyes need to be open and see. Like you said, we're not obligated. Yes, they do us a favor, whatever the circumstances is. But Jesus put you in that position to help somebody. You're not going to take them all the way with you, but you're going to start them off. And you start them on, and they're not continuing in the faith of Jesus Christ. You move on. You tell them thanks. You thank them for what they have done, and you move on. And this is something else was on my spirit, Minister Straker, bringing into the church. You have these TV pastors. They push you down on the floor, and that thing is coming into church. And I remember sometime last week, Pastor Ferdinand mentioned about all you have to do is accept Jesus Christ, and something he was saying about getting the Holy Spirit. They have you tarrying, saying,
tarrying room. Yeah.
Now they're pushing you in your belly for you to spit up. What are you? What do you want me to spit up? You know, you just lay your hand gentle on the person's stomach if you have to touch them in any way. And you just be gentle and just witness to the person, if so be the case. You want to scream and shout and say, not by power nor by might, but by my spirit. You cannot get a person filled. It's the spirit of God that does all things. You know, and these things is what creeping up into church. You punch me in my belly. I start thinking about the punch you punch me in my belly. My mind is off Christ right now. I'm in pain. You know, so we have to get back to know that it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, said the Lord.
Thank you for the call. Thank you for the call, indeed, in Jesus' name.
You're welcome. Be blessed.
Amen. We definitely apologize for Land of My Birth today. We normally air at 1 o'clock. It's a very potent and submissive conversation today, as we look at it, very sobering conversation. And from time to time, this is what we need to get to, the basic fundamental of Christianity. Because as we read Psalms 1, the Bible said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners. Because sinners want to come in. But if we who claim to have received Christ is standing in the way because the light of Christ is not shining and they cannot see that light that they can come into it, we are going to be in problem with God. Amen. Because he said the opposite of blessing is cursing. Amen. So if you don't adhere to this here, this is a problem. And this is Psalms. This is in the Psalms. This is number one Psalm. This is the entry point into the Word of God. When I say the Word of God, because the Psalms is praises. Amen. So if you're going to get there, and many times we as Christians, our resources, we go to the Psalms to read the Psalms and stuff like that. But the Lord is showing you very strategically right here. In Psalms number 1, he's telling you that as you're taking off your shoes to come in before me into all my Psalms, make sure that you are adhering to that first criteria. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. And in his law doeth he meditate day and night. Hallelujah. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. Hallelujah. His leaf also shall not wither. Hallelujah. And whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. First foundation, fundamentally, right here at the top, this is what the Lord is saying. So many times we think we're not prospering in Christ, and we need to watch our counsel. Caller, good morning to you. Grace and peace.
Hello.
Good morning.
Good afternoon. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thank you for the call.
I love your topic. It was good because, Minister Straker, it's time now, because too much of thing going on in the church and it's on the carpet. And it's time as we as Christians, that who have eyes to see, let them see. Because God said in his word, he said, God is a spirit, and they that worship me must worship me in spirit and in truth. It's not all about how you could dress and what you could look like. We need to walk holy, because we don't know the hour or the minute Christ will come. And I will read this thing in Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, when it say, just give me 1 minute. It says,
120.
The mystery of the seven stars which you are saw in my right hand, and the seven golden candlestick. The seven stars are the angel of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which you saw are the seven churches. And I want to encourage believer, you just do what you gotta do, because God did not save us for ourselves. God saved us that we could go out there and let our light shine, that men will see and glorify our Father which art in heaven. It's not all about us, it's all about him. Because people out there, they are hurting, and we cannot be judging. Most we could do is go out there and let our light shine. Because you don't have to tell them you are a Christian. They will see the light in you, and they will want to know, they will ask you. So it's time as we as Christians to let our light shine and let God do the rest.
In Jesus' name. Thank you, my sister.
So you continue to do what you're doing, because it's too much a compromising going on in the church. Because I want to know, if nobody in the church, cannot be something, it's like a family tradition. And it's time for we as believers need to stop and seek the face of God and pray and stop playing churches. We need to stop, because God said in his word, he said he's tired of we repent to him. He said he's a merciful and a forgiving God, but he said he is tired of we coming and repent to him. And he said he's going to use his rod, and his rod is very hot.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
May God bless you.
God bless you too.
And strengthen you. And it's time, because I always say God only going to use one man. You don't have to use the whole church. You're going to use one person to open, because he said we have eyes to see, let me see. And God used you, that you think that under the carpet, that you could bring it out and let people see and serve God the way he wants us to serve him.
Thank you, my sister. God bless you.
And God bless you. May you enjoy the rest of your day.
You too, my sister. Thank you for the call.
Bye-bye.
5 minutes on the other side of the one. And you know, many people might feel that they are not capable to call, because they feel, well, I'm going through little stuff and I'm not holy, and who am I to claim holiness? But God, you know, you have to just claim that you're on the side of Jesus and you're on the side of righteousness. We all have things in our life that we're working on. We are not perfect 100%, but we know what our mind is set on Christ. Our mind is set on righteousness. We know that we want to do it according to God, regardless to what difficulty we are facing. And this is the element that we are talking about. The devil want to keep you muzzled. The devil want to keep you shutting up and not talking about what is wrong and not acting on your faith, and put you in a kind of place where you just feel everything is okay. Like the young lady was mentioning there when she called earlier on, talking about the gunshot. Back in the time, your first time you heard gunshot, oh, gunshot, you run inside. No gunshot going on, you walk in the street, you go in, you're still going where you're going. You don't pay no attention. It's the same thing going on in the body of Christ. We see it going wrong. After a while, if you don't look at it, it come like nothing happening no more. You go every day and don't pay no attention to it, and this is very bad. Caller, good morning to you. Grace and peace.
Good morning, Minister Straker. Grace and peace unto
you. Grace and peace unto you, my brother. Amen.
Yes. I just called to continue the conversation on the topic. Brother Straker, you just have to pray, my brother. You have to make prayers, you know? You have to pray for the church. We have to make intercession prayers. We have to make supplication prayers for all men, Brother Straker. You have to pray on our behalf. That's the best you, me, and others can do. We have to pray and make intercession prayers. Yeah, that's one of the, at least that's one of the things that we can do. Yeah, I just want to leave that time with you today.
Oh, that's what you're saying, we should be praying and making intercession, right?
Yeah, we should be praying, not just intercession prayers, but praying for all the churches as well. Because we have to pray for the church, we have to pray for our pastors, we have to pray for our shepherd, our leader. We have to pray for them. Even if they will fall, we have to pray for them. We have to lift them up in prayers continually. Always pray for our leaders.
Definitely, indeed. We receive that.
We have to. So we have to keep them in prayers. We have to keep them in prayers. So I just, now I will just call and add that to the discussion.
Amen. Thank you, my brother.
You're welcome, my brother.
All right. Amen. Yes. Amen. Of course, that's the element that is most important. We're talking about prayer and stuff like that, and praying for the body of Christ. And of course, the thing about it with all that, you know, once we are willing to receive, you see, the man who is willing to receive, he's not gone too far. He wants to receive. He don't mind if somebody tell him, well, look, my brother, this is contrary to the word of God. He, that person, pray going to work for this man. They, you know, pray will help, because this man is willing to humble and this man is willing to receive. You know, but we're talking about the areas where people have gone so far, they're not even willing to receive. Don't care what you do, their minds are made up. Amen. But overall, what we're talking about is the believers in Christ who feel helpless. You know, they feel that they cannot do it. They want to do it, but they feel that they have to go along with the whole show because everybody's doing it. My friends is still there. Everybody I know is still there. Who am I going to talk to? Everybody's going there. We've been doing this for years. And we're trying to let them know you have to make up your mind and make your calling and your election show according to Christ. Amen. So my brother talking about, we need to pray for this. Of course, we pray for the leaders. We pray for them. And those of you who are in different places and you see, you know, that, you know, things can turn around, you want to pray. But first of all, like I said, if we see the sins, you go to your brother, let them know, look, this is contrary to the word of God. You let them know. The Bible wants you to let them know that you have seen it. Amen. Because if everybody walking in goggles on, nobody can lead. But if you see it, you should let them know. Either they want to receive it or they don't want to receive it. They don't want to receive it, you brush your garments and you brush your feet and you keep moving. That is what the Bible said, and that's what the Bible means. So the point is, you don't have to feel obligated to stand up with people that is living contrary to the word of God. Because he said, blessed is the man that walketh not. It means you are not going along with it. You are not going along with the man that is walking in the counsel of the ungodly. You're not going along with it. Once it's not of God, you're not going along with it. Amen. Hallelujah. 347-663-8638. If you want to chime in on the conversation this morning, feel free. But we just really feel it is very important that we bring this forward. As the time is counting down in these last days, everything is impacting the body of Christ. Everything is in the church. All kinds of things is inside of the church now. And people don't know what to do, how to move, how not to move. The Bible says narrow is the way and few will find it. If you are the few, it means that you are seeking to find a way, to find the right way to make sure you maintain your walk in Christ. So you need to keep looking for that way, because that way is a way that is going to move to the left, to the right. Is going to keep going on, because as we move to the end of the time, men are going to continue to go away from the faith. The Bible tells you very clearly, in latter times, many shall depart from the faith. And hear how they're departing from the faith. They're not leaving the church, you know. They're still in the church. But now they have given heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devil. All kind of thing now they feel is okay to bring. No, we could do that in the church. What's the big deal? Yes, we could do that now. Yes, no problem. And the person was there long years. Say, well, you know, we never did this in church before, you know. Come on, sister, you're too old-fashioned. Come on, you're too old-fashioned. Come on, what's wrong with you? Let's bring in a little dancers. Let's bring in this, let's bring in that. Come on, you know, let's bring in something. And that is what the Bible is saying. They are going to give heeds to seducing spirit and doctrines of devil. Doctrines of devil. Like coming in and say, well, what's wrong? If he love him and she love her, what's the big deal? They're two nice children. We saw them grow up in this church and they went to college and they came back and, you know, she came back with a lover. And what's the big deal? Come on, they're two nice people. It's nothing wrong if they want to come and worship with us. This is what the Bible is saying. They're not leaving the church, but they are now giving heed. They're paying attention. They are listening to it. And the Bible say, what you hear will affect your faith. He didn't say what you hear might affect your faith. No, he knows. Because faith cometh by hearing. So once you're hearing it, it's going to affect your faith. It's going to waver you. It's going to shake you. It's going to move you. It's going to make your conscience become seared. The things of holiness will no longer appeal to you. Hallelujah. And you won't see the difference between holiness and unholiness no more. Because your conscience becomes seared. You become a reprobate mind. So you're right in the church with the ungodliness and nothing wrong with it no more. As a matter of fact, the person who pointed out to you say, girl, you're mad or what? You crazy? Come on, what's wrong with that? Oh, he's all right. Come on. So what's wrong if he married and he have another woman on his side? I understand his wife doesn't even do this. His wife doesn't even go to a movie. His wife doesn't even want to do. So what's wrong if he have another woman to make him happy? What's wrong? And we give heed to all these seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And this is what the Bible is talking about. So it means the church number would stay high. People would be in the church, but the church would not be in them. Christ would not be in them. They will move away from the faith. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So this is what we're talking about, that we be diligent, that we stay, if we want to make it, we stay on what the Lord say. We stay on the truth of the word of God. Hallelujah. I remember going to one, me and my wife went to one place in Queens, and I think they was having some kind of dance. Even they had a pastor there, and the pastors, and they were, you know, some kind of, you know, Christian-oriented thing. And the guy was wearing some tight pants, like tight tights. And then, like, you know, I mean, how is God in that? How is God in that? How could God be in that? How could holiness be in that? How could righteousness be in that? How? How could holiness be in that? How? All your body outside. How could God be in that? How could God be in that? How? Yes, he said to give praise in the dance. Yes, give praise in the dance. How? With dignity, respect, reverence for God. Amen. So the dressing must be of standard. It must be of caliber. It must be of respect. that you don't cause a man to stumble. Amen? Because all kind of people out in the world, in the congregation, whatever it is, and if you come and overexpose yourself, what you expect? You're going to cause somebody to stumble. Take a second look. You're going to cause somebody to stumble. And all those things, we are giving heed to what the world is doing and bring it into the church and not realize that we're causing it to defile the body of Christ. Amen? So hallelujah, we praise the name of the Lord. We know that time come, we're not going to be popular. You see, that's what the Bible speak about. You will be persecuted for righteousness. You will be persecuted for holiness. You will be persecuted. Amen. So all those who seek in popularity, you understand, if you seek in popularity, you are going away from God. If you're seeking for everybody to love what you're doing, you're going to be going away from God, because you're seeking for crowd. You're looking for people to recognize you. You're looking to be among the biggest, the brightest. Everybody that's shining, you want to be among them. You're not seeking God no more. That's the reason why everybody want a title. Everybody want to be called something. Everybody want to be put on a pedestal. Amen. And it's the devil that is coming and ransacking the church, and nobody's paying attention. Amen. So that's why the Bible said, the blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Amen. The unrighteous, the unholy. Amen. Hallelujah. We just thank God for the presence of the Holy Spirit so strong in the studio today. And I'm telling you, we just override a whole lot of things in the studio this morning. Like I tell you, this enemy, when he know you're going to come with something, he try his best. But your best is not good enough, devil. We have the victory in Jesus' name. Amen. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Amen. Allow your spirit to groove to it and go to it. In the name of Jesus. Amen. If you want to call, the phone is open. We're going to keep the phone open until about 2 o'clock today. We're going to keep the phone open. We're going to just dwell on this conversation as we dwell on Psalms 1. If you have your Bible, take it out and read Psalms 1 and see what God is saying. Understand that the opposite of blessing is cursing. Hallelujah. And the Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Amen. And many things going on cannot be conducive with a godly life, cannot be contained with righteous people, should not be a part of it, should not be named among us as people who call in the name of Jesus Christ. In the second line, look at what he said, and standeth not in the way of sinners. Please don't stand in the way of the sinner man. Sinner man want to see Christ in you. God is telling you, no. Don't stand up in his man way. It's either you're in or you're out. Don't block my children from coming to me. Do not do it. Don't receive my light and put it under a bushel. He said, woe be unto the shepherd that lead the sheep astray. Glory to the name of Jesus. The word is alive. Just the same.
One, two, three.
It has not changed. 347-663-8638. If want you want to bring a comment, you want to share with us, feel free. 17 minutes after 1 o'clock.
When you feel afraid.
We know this program is not for everybody. Some people don't have to turn their radio off because it's too much for you. You want some music, you want some dancing, you want to stay where you are, you want to feel what you want to feel, you want to feel your emotions.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Yes. The Bible said the time will come when they will no longer endure sound doctrine.
You are not alone if you are alone.
They will heap to themselves
when you feel afraid.
Teachers, you will tell them what they want to hear.
We are all the same.
And they all will perish.
Need a mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need.
347-663-8638. We're talking about Psalms 1. Uncle Blue and your wife.
Never ends. And all the people said amen. If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know, love is what we're after.
Listen to the song.
And all the people say.
God knows we stumble and fall, but our mind is made up on Jesus. We want to do it, Father. We want to get there. We want to run this race and finish our course. And that's all you got to know this morning, that your mind is made up, that you really want to make it. You want to make it to glory land. You want to see the face of God. Regardless of what you're facing, what you're going through, you know in your mind, in your heart, you really want to do it unto the Lord. And that is the basic you have to keep in your mind as you listen to this program. Don't care what you're going through. Don't care what you're facing. Don't care what somebody going to tell you to make you feel less of a Christian, less of a believer. You don't have to worry with them. You know your Father know your heart. You know your Father know your intention. Amen. You know, somebody might listen and say, well, oh, you think he holy? We talking about holy? Yeah, you could say what you want, but we know who we are in Christ. We know our intention is right. We know we really want to make it according to the Lord and the word of the Lord, and he's going to give us the strength. He's going to help us to achieve that goal. Amen. But we must be persuaded according to the word of God that we're going to do what the Lord said to do. We're going to stand up for righteousness. We're going to stand up for truth. Amen. And like I said, this morning the projection is to bring it to those who feel weak, those who feel obligated because of family or whatever it is, obligated to stay a part of what is wrong. You feel that you must stay with them because look what they have done for you. When you went through a rough time, they were there for you. Yeah, well, good. I thank you and bye-bye. Hallelujah. I'm going with Jesus. Yes, thank you, Lord. Amen. You promise somebody something because they don't want their papers. They promise to marry to you, but they want to live contrary to the word of God. Mm-mm. I ain't going along with that. Your Father's hand is big enough to provide for you. You, that is what it is about, faith. And we were talking about fear of faith. Many people say they have faith, but they're operating in fear because they have bills to pay, they have things to do, they have the building to pay off, whatever it is. Hey, where is God in your equation? You say you have faith. You tell the congregation to have faith in God. Where is your faith in God? Why are you doing things contrary to try to raise the money? Why are you not doing what God tells you to do? Then he will provide. Amen. Why you don't do what he said to do? Why you don't seek the souls? Then he gonna make the souls come. Then the money gonna come. Why don't you have faith in God? Why you don't keep doing what the Lord said to do? Why are you going contrary to the word of God to fulfill what you want to fulfill? Not faith. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. He's worthy. Our God is the same God. Call a good morning to you. Grace and peace.
Good morning to you, my brother. How are you doing?
Grace and, I'm doing great. Hallelujah.
Oh. Well, I'm trying my best to do great too.
Hallelujah. That's all it is. That's all it is.
I was listening to the topic and from the time you doing things like that, you didn't go under the water and come back out in the newness of life. You see, when you come back in the newness of life, all these old things, they leave behind, you know? Because when God brought the children to the promised land, this is what he told them in Deuteronomy. He said, now, these are the commandments, the statutes, the judgment, which the Lord your God command you to teach you, that you might do them in the land whether you go to possess it, that you might fear the Lord thy God and keep his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee, thou and thy sons' sons, and all the days of thy life, and that the days may be prolonged. Hear, therefore, O Israel, and observe it to do it, that it might be well with you, and that you may increase mightily as the Lord your God has promised thee in the land that floweth with milk and honey. O Israel, the Lord your God is one Lord, one Lord. If you get that kind of teaching from more, that cover two and four generation. And if you come up with that kind of thing and then still go on be baptized and doing these kind of things, you heading in the wrong direction.
Hallelujah.
Yes. And the ungodly now, the counselor, the ungodly, well, when God was on earth and Jesus was on the sea running to all these Sadducees and all these ungodly people, they were on a council too. And they were against everything that he did and that was true and good. So that's the work of the ungodly. To go against everything that God say. So that's the problem I had. So you have a nice evening. Mm-hmm. You and your beautiful wife.
Thank you, my brother. Thank you for the call. Thank you for the comment, indeed.
Okay.
Amen.
Bye-bye.
24 minutes after 1, we're going to keep the phone open until 2 o'clock on The Conversation. We're talking about righteousness and holiness. And we're reaching out mainly to those who feel that they don't have the power to seek the counsel of God to fulfill the will of God in their life, that they can walk with God and make sure that they will make their calling and their election sure. Amen. So we want to reach out to you, let you know you don't have to let nobody bind you. Nobody bind you down. If what they're doing is contrary to God, you need to rise up and move out and step out. Ask God for the power to give you the strength that you will continue, because you want to make your calling and your election show. God is not coming for no group of people. God is coming for chosen people who believe in Jesus and walked upright before Him.
You are not alone if you are lonely.
And a caller mentioned about the witchcraft in the church and stuff. And you know, people might take this thing like it's just a regular conversation. You'll be surprised to know what is going on. And if you out there and you feel, I wonder why, I mean, all these wrong things, why am I still there? Why do I still go along? And I know, you got to pay attention. You have to seek the counsel of God, because those things are real as real as real. If you don't think it's real, well, you need to check again, because the word of God is true. Amen. He said, we are wrestling not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, and those principalities are so profound. Amen. Because the thing about it is, people who really have truly never encountered Jesus, to them, they believe the things of God are some kind of business thing. They think it's just a joke, you know, like people grow up in the church but never have really received Christ as their Lord and Savior. So what their parents taught them to do, they just did it. What they saw people doing, they just do it. You just sing, they just sing the song. They don't think that it have any spiritual attributes to it or any spiritual applications to it. They don't think nothing will happen if you pray or you ask for forgiveness. They don't believe, because they have never experienced it. So these people are out there like ravenous wolves, because to them, they believe the church business is a business. They think the things of God is a business. The more people they see, the more money they see. They don't see nothing spiritual. And we have to understand that those things are alive among us. But there are many people who think like you praying and say you praying for this. They think, come on, what you praying about? This, that don't mean nothing. There are people among you, trust me, who do not believe in the word of God the way you believe in it. Those of you, some of you have experienced Christ in your life, and you know that Christ is real. You know you cannot play with God. Some people don't think it's real. Some people think it's a thing to do on Sunday. Some people think it's a tradition. I'm telling you, I know you, that's what you think. Some people are like that. Some people really don't believe. Because like I said, some things that people do to really encounter Jesus Christ and do it is almost impossible. To function out of the will of God and experience Christ and know that Christ is real, understand that hell is real, and all these things that God is saying is real, trust me. To do it, you have to be totally reprobate, where your mind gone. You're like a man that gone on drugs. You gone. You don't know right from wrong. You're totally gone, or you have never experienced Jesus or the saving power of Jesus. To you, you think it's just something to do on Sunday, something that we do. Since I was small, we did it. I just do it. We just do it. We don't think nothing serious about it. And those people are the most dangerous to encounter, because they don't believe in the seriousness of the judgment of God. And that is a bad place to be, because if you never encounter Jesus, a lot of things to you. My wife will tell you right now a revelation she had when a friend, or I think a cousin of hers, that died. And she was asking God, I want you to show me where she went, because we remember before she died, my wife was, you know, trying to minister to her about the Lord, receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. Why are you always in this carnival thing? Are you always in this party stuff? And she was telling my wife, come on, say you're not preaching now. Say you're preaching now. Huh? You're preaching now. You're preaching to me. And she was talking all this kind of stuff. And my wife was, when she died, my wife got a shock. My wife was shocked. My wife called me. She said, you know who died? I said, who? And she told me, I said, my God. And for the rest of the day, my wife was sick. Sick about it in her spirit. And she was trying to figure out, why am I so sick about this? Yes, it's a family member, whatever it was. And my wife was seeking the Lord and asking the Lord, I want to see where she went. I want to see what happened to her. And one night, my wife wake up sweating. My wife said, my God, if she see where this girl went. And the Lord show her, three men came and took this lady and put her in a chopper into a dark room. Dark, you could cut it with a knife. And she saw that three men took that lady and pushed her into a sort of outer darkness kind of situation. And my wife woke up sweating. My God. My wife is so serious about the things of God now because of that experience too. You know, so when we have experienced Christ in some way, those of us who understand, we're not willing to play with God. We're not willing to play because we have had an encounter. And everybody who have experienced and have a testimony of God and seen God work, we don't want to play with God because he has shown us something. We have a revelation of God. We've seen that God is real. We know that God is real. So brethren, your testimony of what God has done in your life and where God has taken you from and how God has illuminated your life in some way, how can you then walk away from that as if you didn't see, as if you never observed nothing, as if you don't know, as if you're deaf, as if you're blind? How could we walk away after God has expressed himself to us? After we see the testimony of God, after we see what he has done in our life, when we see what God has done with us, when we see people who we know, we thought they could have never changed, they would have never walked again. When we see what God has done in the life of many people, how could we walk contrary to what is coming? The Bible says, appointed unto man once to die, then come the judgment. What judgment? Is there a judgment? Yes! That's what the Bible said. The Bible said, then come the judgment. Hallelujah. So once we know there is a judgment, we got to make sure that we are walking. When that judgment come, at least we lay it all in the hands of the Lord. We can only do the best we can based on the power that God give us. But we must be willing to seek righteousness because God know the heart of man. God know what we're going through. God know what we're facing. God know. But he know our intention. He know our heart is right. He know we are seeking the truth. He know we are seeking to stand on the truth. That's why the Bible says, too much is given, much is required of you. If God know he give you a brain, you could read, you could spell, you know right from wrong, he show you. And you're still going contrary. My God, your punishment going to be severe because you know you have what it takes. That's why the Bible says, I have many sheep in different fold. He understand that some people are in some places where they have no control over the situation. They don't know how to get out. They don't know what to do. But to you who hear this word and have all your faculties in check, you could walk, you could talk, you could make a decision. As a matter of fact, there are many people that could curse people in the world. Hallelujah. They could curse people in the world. But those, those who they really have to give it to, they don't give it to them. They will curse their husband, they will curse their wife, they will curse everybody else around them. But those people who they have to let them know, I am a child of God, and you ain't going to cause me to lose my salvation, they refuse to open them out. They refuse to talk about it. They refuse. And of course, in some cases, they cannot. Because in some cases, they are bound with spiritual wickedness. And some people don't believe that. Some people don't believe it. As much as the Bible display that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, those people don't put nothing like that into consideration. They don't even believe it. Somebody might want to know, how did you stay with that person all these years? After they beat you and they do all this thing, how could you live with that person all these years? They do all this. You don't think there is something else going on? You don't believe there is something else at play? Of course, there are many more things at play. And we need to be vigilant, sober about the word of God and the things of God and the applications that God tells us to look out for, to watch out, beware of those things, because those things are true and they are alive and they are in total operation right now. Amen. So Psalms 1 is our foundation today. If you have your Bible, read it. You are a believer in Christ. Somebody might sit there and say, I wonder this guy trying to get the church empty and get people out of church. Well, if you're doing right, we got to leave you, my brother. We got to go. We got to go. We got to leave. If you're going to continue with your ungodly practice, we just got to go. Hey, we got to go. Hasta la vista, baby. We got to leave. And that's what the Lord is saying. Walk not in those counsel of the ungodly men that don't want to even hear the right counsel. They don't want to take your word into consideration. They don't want to listen to truth. They don't want to come around to the truth. They don't want to repent. They feel they're too big. Who are you to tell me what we're doing? You just came here. Who are you? What you know? You just got born again last week. What are you talking about? Well, we got to leave. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So if you're sitting out there and you feel you don't have what it takes, God is telling you, yes, you have what it takes. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And you lean to me, I will show you. I will direct you. But you know what? First of all, you must be willing that I'm God. I want to do what is right unto you. I don't care what man will do to me. I want to do what is right unto you, God, in the name of Jesus. Let's go back to the phone. Caller, good afternoon. Turn off your radio.
God bless you, man.
God bless you, my brother.
And thank you. You teach me the Lord a lot about the Bible. Amen. About Jesus.
Amen.
So the Lord bless you, man.
Yes, my brother. Thank you very much.
Yeah, man. So, all right, yes, sir.
Thank you, my brother. God bless you, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hello, and Henry. Thank you, the Lord is working on you, my brother. Your voice sounds so much clearer indeed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And something that people are not willing to face, even believers. The Bible says, look, what I face when I walk the earth, it's going to happen to you. People going to persecute you for my name's sake, for my truth's sake, for my righteousness' sake. But when people see it, people feel, well, oh, it's kind of unfair. It's not right. But that's what the Lord said. You will be persecuted. If you are willing to stand up for righteousness, you will be persecuted. You will not have a lot of support. A lot of people will not be with you. That is what the Lord is saying. Amen. Are you willing to stand up with the gospel? Or are you willing to go with the crowd? Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Are you with the crowd or are you with Jesus? Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus had a crowd. When he said to them, you came to, you really want to go along with this? Many turn back and walk away. Many turn back and walk away because he told them the true counsel. Many turn back and walk away. And this is what he said going to happen in the latter times. Many shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. Giving heed to seducing spirit and doctrines of devils. Amen. So they will still be in the church, but everything they're doing will not be of a spiritual context or content. Amen. They're doing things that is not spiritual, not righteous, not holy. This is what the Lord is saying. Let's go back to the phone again. Caller, good morning to you. Good afternoon. Grace and peace.
My name is Trita. Would you please take me off the phone?
We can do it when the segment... Well, call me when the segment is over. If you want to speak to me off the air, call me when the segment is over.
I'm not too sure about that because I'm getting ready to go out right now.
Well, if you're getting ready to go out, my sister, when you have the time, we can definitely elaborate on whatever it is you like to speak about.
Yeah, because you talk to me.
Caller, good afternoon. Grace and peace to you. Caller, go ahead. You're live.
Praise the Lord, Minister Stricker.
Amen.
And as you talk about the church is going to be empty, it doesn't matter. Many are called and few are chosen. And the thing is, the Bible said, no chasing at the time feels good. But if you love the Lord and the word find you, take heed to the word and move on. Change your ways if you are a lover of God, right? That's what we do. We just take heed to the word and we change our dirty habits and come right with God. Many are called and few are chosen. So a lot of people who don't want to call because their church people listen to the radio and stuff like that. We have to know that if they hate you because of what you're saying, defending the word of God, they don't like God either. So we just have to know that the word is the word and it will never change. It's the truth, the way, and the life. And that's where we have to go in order to get to heaven. Amen?
Amen. And my sister, what the Bible depicts very clearly, if you understand, the Bible say, whosoever. It means God is not forcing anybody to believe or to walk right or to do what he's saying. God is not forcing nobody. So sometimes you feel like you're trying to get people all you want. God is not forcing nobody. God tell you his counsel, he tell you what he's about, and either you choose to go his way or you don't want to go his way. As a matter of fact, you still prosper even if you don't believe in God. If you plant and you plant the seed and you water it, it bear just the same way. He rain on the just and on the unjust. So God is not forcing nobody to live right, but you know what? If you don't live right, you're going to perish if you don't live right. But he's not forcing you. You can choose to be how you want to be. And that's what I love about God. And that's why we should love God, because God don't force nobody. God is not begging you. If you don't want to line up with him, no, he will still prosper you all the way till the day you die. You plant, you sow, you invest, you're gonna make a crop. But you know what? When that breath leaves you, hell is waiting for you. God is an honest God. God is a good God, my sister. Amen.
I fear God.
What a God we're talking about this morning. Jesus.
And we have to look at it just as we look at our children. Because when our children don't do something right, we seem to want to punish them. And if we know that we grow them up in the right way, see, they go off to college, they get their degree and everything, something will come of them because they went the right way. And if Jesus is the way, why not go the right way? And if you go away from the right way, you shall perish. You shall get your punishment. It's as simple as that. And we're not here to make anybody feel good. It's not about feel good. It's to follow the way of God. He's the only way. The only way. There's no other way. And let nobody else tell you different. It's one way to make it to heaven. And it's through Jesus Christ.
Amen. 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 Thank you. And like I said, we're just trying to wake up those who feel that they don't have what it takes to follow what is right. Because what is wrong is so overwhelming before you. We're letting you know that, you know, God, the same God you believe that created heaven and earth, he has the power to lead you and guide you and direct you and keep you. Amen. To the previous caller, you were saying to me that you wanted to speak to me off the air, and you was trying to say something. I don't know if you really wanted to talk or you didn't want to talk, because the conversation is going on the air live on the phone. I said to you, if you want to speak to me after the situation is over, you can call me when the segment is over. And then I will engage with you, all right? So I didn't deliberately cut you off, but you were saying you didn't want to speak. You wanted to talk to me off the air. Then after you were saying something in between, so I think you wasn't too sure what you wanted to do, okay? So I wasn't intending to cut you off. Caller, good afternoon. Turn off your radio, please. All right. Call me back, caller. Turn off your radio when you get on the phone. We're dealing with Psalms 1. For all the believers in Christ, as we embark on the last times, for those who believe, those who were led by the Spirit of God, and see all that's going on, I know that we're in the last days. There's no time to play with your salvation. Three, 4, 7, 6, 6, 3, 8, 6, 3, 8. We're gonna shut down the phone line at 2 o'clock. We're dealing with Psalms 1. This is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Don't care where they're from. Don't care what is the family relation. You gotta make your calling and your election sure. Do not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Many times we feel that God is not blessing us, God is not on our side. We've been looking for this, looking for that. But what counsel are you walking in? What counsel are you walking in? What are you condoning? What are you a part of? Our God is just and fair. Thank you, Jesus. 15 more minutes in the segment.
You are not alone if you are lonely. When you feel afraid, you're not the only. We're all the same in need of mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen.
Hallelujah.
If you're rich,
347-663-8638. Amen. We give him praise, we give him honor, we give him glory today as he has given us another day in the land of the living. We are blessed to be alive.
God knows we stumble and fall.
All the folks on the jobs listening, we thank you for taking the time out. We ask you to listen with an open heart and an open spirit. Amen. And of course, the devil is you know, it's just like the way they paint Satan. They paint Satan in such a when you see anything like, say, oh, that's devil. Well, based on the Bible description of Satan, that's not Satan. Amen. And everything the devil is going to do to get into your space, he's not going to come in a raw way, like raw. So like, oh, man, this is so outrageous. No, he's going to come very nice, very calm, very cool. Very submissive, very cool, very nice. You know, like, that couldn't be the devil. Come on, that's too nice. Come on, sister. That's not bad. Come on. Oh, come on. You're making a big deal out of nothing. Oh, everybody does it. They does it in California. Yes, I saw a video with it. Everybody's doing it all over the world. That's the new thing now. Oh, come on, sister. Come on, you too uptight. Come on. Take a breather. Come on. Dog, what's the big deal? No, that's okay. That's all right. God understand. Yes, God understand. So that's where we are right now in the dispensation of the gospel. That's where we are. We're in the place where the devil is coming in as an angel of light. He's not coming in no kind of way where you know, well, no. He's coming where he put on the light now. Amen. Because we have gotten bright. We have gotten brilliant. So he's putting bright with bright. Amen. Hallelujah. So that's where we are right now. That's where we are. Everything is looking conducive to the gospel. Everything is looking Christ-like. Everything is looking good. Amen. But is it Christ? Is it the right spirit? The Bible said to try the spirit. Amen. God is a holy God. Is everything holy according to the standard of holiness? Is the Holy Spirit with it? Hallelujah. It looks good, but is it the Holy Spirit? Amen. Hallelujah. We thank God for Jesus. Amen. We thank him. Hallelujah. His word will never return void. Amen. His word will never return void. Amen. And you know, the thing about life is that once you get used to something, it's hard to move to something new. Imagine you're living in a neighborhood and, you know, you wake up in the morning and you go to the park and you jog and you live in a nice neighborhood. Even if a real better place come up for you, you think, man, I could never leave that area. Come on, man, I'm so used to this right here. You know what I mean? You get so used to something sometimes. When the real thing come on, new things come, it's hard for you to attach to it because you've been so long in something. Amen? You've been so long with something, you feel it's hard to let go of that. It's hard because I'm so conditioned. My mind is so conditioned to this. I've been going to that place for years. Everybody know me. I'm a part of this for years. I'm doing this. Amen. And what these guys do, who know what they're doing is wrong, when they have talented people or good people or people who have potential to be able to do things, whatever it is, they try to lock them in. You give them a title, give them a name, now they are obligated. You know, so now they feel obligated to do the duty of God that they cannot leave. Now it's harder for them to think. So now they have to fight between, you know, am I pleasing God, or I wonder if God going to be mad with me if I, although this is wrong, I mean, because they give me a position or because I have a name, I have a title, or because they make me do this, make me do that. I mean, am I, what am I going to do? I mean, am I going to disrespect God if I walk away from the house of God, even if the actions is not of God, even though they say it's the house of God, but what is going on is not of God. But you now caught between, like, am I pleasing God? Or I wonder if God's going to be mad with me if I, although this is wrong. I mean, the Bible says that, but what they're doing is not right. But, you know, so so all those things are at play. The flesh of man, and man is trying to do what they want to accomplish. So they will use every tactic, every witchcraft they can use to keep you or to bound you or to bind you, that you don't move away, you don't get away from them, that you stay with them. They will use every method they can, every single thing they can. And the Bible tells you, no, it's not that. It's not by might, it's not by power, but by my spirit. Amen. You have people who will get a prophet from somewhere to come in and try to get the church full up. Well, if the prophet come and people come and receive Christ, and they didn't receive Christ in their whole heart and soul, in their spirit, they're not going to function, because they have not really received Christ. They received Christ under some kind of false, something that you put up, something that you pretended to bring them in, or to try to get them, or to woo them in. Amen. So they're not going to really stay. They're not going to be productive like that. If they didn't come in by the Spirit of God, if they didn't receive Christ in spirit and truth, they cannot be no function for the body of Christ. You're just going to have more headache, more havoc. Amen. Because Bible says, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, said the Lord. Amen. Amen. So sometimes you use all these different extracurricular methods to try to get people to fool up your church. And for what? For what? If God called you in ministry, just do the will of the Lord. Just do what God said to do. He's gonna fool the church if you want to. Whatever you want to do, he's gonna do it. His will will be done. If you do his will, he will prosper you by doing his will. Amen. If you're doing your will, you will have to do your way to get your will filled. Amen. Yes. So many times we want to do our will, so we have to lean to whatever it is that we can do, whatever we want to do to fulfill our will. Amen. But once we do his will, he said to go into all the world, preach the gospel. How many of us are really going into the world to preach the gospel to get people who are not saved saved? Most of the time what the church is just doing is just have a group. Every week we come and just sing to each other, pray to each other, dance with each other. We're not looking for nobody else. We're happy together. What a happy family. Oh, happy family. Oh, we come and we dance around. Are we going out and looking for souls? Are we seeking the lost at any cost? Hallelujah. Amen. So we just give God thanks as we climb to the top of the hour. 8 more minutes to the top of the hour. Yes, we thank God for Jesus. We thank him because he's a faithful God. He's a true God. Amen. And then you're talking about the selling in the church of food. And why would you sell food? I mean, in all this abundance, how much it costs for a pound of rice, 2 pounds of rice, 5 pounds of rice, you know, throw it in a pot, throw some water, put a little thing, you know, hey, throw it in a taxi, whatever, bring it to the church. Everybody eat a few spoon of rice, hey, you know, give thanks, praise God. What's the big deal? How hard is that to do in a big congregation or whatever congregation, 10 people, 20 people, whatever it is? How difficult is that to do for God, for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, for his children, for his people? How difficult, how hard is this to do for anybody to just bring some food that we can fellowship together? How difficult is that? How expensive is that? Some beans, a little beans, 99 cents beans, a few beans, you mix it in the rice and you stir it up in a pot. And, hey! Some small cups and, you know, everybody eat and be merry. Thank God for Jesus. We go home. Do we must sell it to them? You must create a restaurant in the restaurant. You know, you have a restaurant. And Sunday restaurant, you know. Don't be offended, brethren. Amen. We're just talking about the word of God, and God is well able. Our God is a big God and he will supply according. Amen. So we need to keep seeking him. in all our ways. Don't be offended by the word of God. The word of God is true, amen. We know it's sharp and it cut deep. We know it leaves some deep wounds, amen. But we lick our wounds and we say, God, let your will be done in my life. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy, God. Father, we thank you for every caller who call and express something, God, that will help to lift somebody's spirits up, God, to know that you are still seeking us, God. You are still seeking to save that which was lost, Father God. Father, we know that we didn't bring this conversation because of ourselves or what we're trying to do. We know we're not targeting any church or any denomination or any group or any pastor or any people, God. Father, we know we just want to do your will according to the Spirit of God. Father, we thank you that you have completely surrounded this conversation. And everybody who have listened, God, Father, we thank you that you are able to touch their heart, God, to know that this is your word, this is your will, because you wish to for us not to perish, but you wish for us to prosper, God. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Lord, that you love us so much. We thank you, God, you have saved us, God, that now we can listen to this kind of programming or to this kind of music or to this kind of thing. We are thinking different from the world, God. Father, continue to mold us and shape us and groom us, God, because we know that you love us, God. We just thank you, Jesus. Thank you for having your way in this segment. We bless your holy name today. We bless all the hearers, God. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We just thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for having your way.
1, 2, 3, 4.
4 more minutes before we shut down the phone line down on the conversation. We thank every caller who have called and shared with us. And one thing I say, brethren, let's not let the word of God offend us. We are not bigger than God. Amen. Any man who feels that the word of God is like, you know, you cannot, we're not bigger than the word of God. We're not bigger than God. Amen. Let's not allow this thing to offend us. We hear the word of God. If it's true and we are in error of it, let us just, you know, repent before God and say, God, we want to do it right. Amen. Help us to do it right, because he will give you the strength to do it right and make it right. Let us not rebel against the word of God. Amen. Thank you.
6, 5.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
You are not alone. If you are lonely, when you feel afraid, you're not the only. We're all the same. In need of mercy.
It is such a powerful song. Hope you have been paying attention to the lyrical content of this song. We don't just play songs for beat and song for song. We play songs for content. Amen. What they're saying in the spirit. What is being revealed in the word of God. Amen. So this song is a very powerful song. It's the blessed, blessed, blessed the man with the poor, that is poor in heart, amen, poor in spirit, amen, you know, blessed are those people, amen, you feel that you're nothing, you're something to God, amen, you're something to God, amen, amen, he loved the humble and the meek, amen, glory to the name of Jesus, amen. So everybody out there this morning, we just thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for your presence, we thank you, Lord, that you brought us through this segment, we thank you, Lord, we thank you, Lord, we thank you, we give you all praise, all honor and all glory all belong to you, Jesus. Amen. It's all about you, Father. It's just doing your will. We submit ourselves to you, God, that you're going to use us for your honor and for your glory. We submit to you, God. We thank you, Father. We thank you for every call of your children who were strong enough and bold and brave to proclaim, thus saith the Lord, and to stand on the side of this truth here that we have expressed, God. Father, we pray that leaders or people in areas, administrations and body of Christ, God, they will take this word serious, God, because no man knows the hour when he is going to leave this earth, God. Let's pray that we all who have listened this word have took it into consideration based on your word, God. We thank you for Psalms number 1 as we read it right now in its entirety as we shut down this segment. Psalms 1 said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doeth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. And we believe it. Thus said the Lord, according to the word of God. And everybody say amen. We love you in Jesus' name. Be blessed.
I'm leaning on the everlasting arms of Jesus until the day he comes. Though I know it's not the good that I have done, I know through Jesus there's a victory to be won. If I don't make it, it's only me to be blamed, for I'm in want time and time again. I wanna make heaven my home. I don't wanna labor in vain. Heaven my home. Lord, help me to make it in. For no matter what it takes, I really wanna make. My defense. Though temptations often come my way, the hands of Jesus will guide me day by day. And though the way to life, it's a narrow path, I'll sacrifice until this world has passed. I wanna make heaven my home. I don't wanna labor in vain. Heaven my home. And now that I know, what's right from what's wrong, I'm gonna keep holding on. My home.